To welcome everyone to the fourth meeting of the Education and Skills Committee. Can I please remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones as they can interfere with the sound system. Agenda item one is item in private. The next item of business is to consider taking item eight in private, where the committee will be discussing its work practices. Are we agreed that we will take item eight in private? Thank you. Agenda item two is to take evidence on the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, part four and five. Part 5 complaints, revocation order 2016. I welcome John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, and government officials Hannah Keats, Better Life Chances Unit, Elizabeth Blair, Solicitors Food, Children, Education, Health and Social Care. Good morning, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make opening comments.
Thank you, Convener. The primary purpose of the revocation order is to revoke the Children and Young People Scotland Parts 4 and 5 Complaints Order 2016, which was passed by Parliament in its last session. The original complaints order was made under the powers in sections 30 and 43 in the 2014 Act. These specify that Scottish ministers may, by order, make provision about the making, consideration and determination of complaints concerning the exercise of functions conferred by or under Parts 4 and 5 of the Act. As Parts 4 and 5 of the Act had been intended to be commenced on the 31st of August this year, the complaints order had set out the complaints process relating to the named person service and the child's plan that would have commenced with the other provisions in these parts of the Act. On the 28th of July, the Supreme Court ruled that the information sharing provisions in Part 4 of the 2014 Act were incompatible with Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights and that changes were needed to make those provisions compatible with the article. This decision took place during the parliamentary recess but required urgent action. As a result, I wrote to the Parliament, and indeed to yourself, Convener, setting out my intention to suspend commencement and introduce the necessary commencement partial revocation order with respect to Parts 4 and 5 of the Act as a whole. As a result, those parts of the Act did not commence on the 31st of August. As Part 4 and 5 did not commence, it is therefore necessary to revoke the complaints order. Clearly, a complaints process cannot be in place when the duties under those parts of the Act have not been commenced. No consultation has taken place on this order, and there are no additional financial implications arising from the order. And I'll be happy to deal with any questions, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Does anybody have any questions? Okay. In that case, we now move on to item three, which is a formal debate on motion S5M-1327 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. I will remind everyone that officials are not permitted to contribute to the formal debates, and I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion.
Moved, Convener.
Does anybody have any comments to make in that case? I will now put the question to the committee. That motion S5M-1327 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. The committee must report to Parliament on this instrument. Are members content for me as convener to sign off for a very short and factual report? Thank you. Agenda item four is to consider the named person's training, qualifications, experience and position and the child's plan, brackets Scotland, revocation order 2016, brackets SSI 216-234, the end brackets. This is a negative instrument and will come into force unless Parliament agrees to a motion to annul it. No motion to annul has been lodged. Do members have any comments on this instrument? No, thank you very much. We then move on to item five in the agenda. The committee is seeking an update on the named person's policy as a follow-up to the ministerial statement made to the Parliament by the Cabinet Secretary last week. We'll move on to questions from members shortly, but I understand the Cabinet Secretary wishes to make a brief opening statement.
I'll leave my comments as I said to Parliament on Thursday, Convener. I'm quite happy to answer questions from members this morning.
Okay, thank you. If you don't mind, I'll start off by asking the first question. Cabinet Secretary, Highland Local Authority is often mentioned as an area where a similar scheme to named persons with a single point of contact has been in place now for a number of years. And from what the reports have been, it's had very positive outcomes from it, better working practices, less children in care, etc. Given this, why do you think there's been a difficulty in getting across what I'm sure you consider to be the potentially positive returns from a named person scheme to the public? Also, given, however, the latest legal judgment, could you confirm what advice has been given to local authorities who, like Highland, have already started to nominate named persons and put arrangements in place for them to be a single point of contact?
I think there's two points in there, Convener. The first is in relation to the public understanding and acceptance of the named person concept. I think there's been a very active political debate around the contents of named person, and that's obviously a contested debate. I disagree fundamentally with many things that have been said in that debate that have been marshalled in opposition to the concept of the Supreme Court policy, the named person policy. And what I set out to do in the statement that I made to Parliament last Thursday was to set out what I consider to be the proper context within which the named person policy has been developed. And that context is the policy approach which has been shared between a number of different administrations and supported by many parliamentary committees, and indeed reflected in the thinking and the priorities of the Christie Commission, that we should have a significant emphasis on preventative interventions to avoid difficulties emerging and become serious challenges for individuals within our society. And that comes through the thinking around, for young people, getting it right for every child. So for me, the challenge is to get across a message which is that the named person as a point of contact to provide assistance and support to individuals who may face difficulty is a policy approach enshrined in the ethos of getting it right for every child, and we have to stress the advantages of that to individuals within Scotland, and that will dominate the communication and the dialogue that I take forward in this respect. I think the evidence is strong on the effectiveness of the approach to the named person concept. I recounted in my statement to Parliament last week the reduction in referrals to the children's panel and the reduction in the acceleration or intensification of cases as a consequence of this intervention. And I think that's been that evidence, I think, justifies the approach that has been taken in policy terms. Finally, convener, in relation to the question of the existing legal framework, the provisions of this part of the Children and Young People's Act have not been enacted. They have not come into force. So therefore, it is important that any provisions that any schemes that are taken forward must be compatible with the existing legal framework within which the such schemes must operate. And again, I set out to Parliament last Thursday the requirement for such provisions to be embedded in the existing legislation around the Human Rights Act and the Data Protection Act, both of 1998, and any public authority must design a scheme that is compatible with that approach, and that would form the guidance that the government has issued in relation to these questions to any public authority.
Thank you very much. It's a short supplementary from you, Richard. And then Liz.
Well, it was just to pick up on that, the Highland experience. Is there evidence that in the Highlands there's the same kind of opposition that some people are expressing over the national rollout of named person?
Well, clearly there's been comments and contributions to the debate in right across the country on this question, and I don't think the Highland area will have been in any way exempted from this. However, I think what has been clear from the Highland experience, you know, if we look at the data, the number of referrals to the Children's Reporter in Highland dropped from 2,335 in 2007 to 744, a drop of 68%, which is a quite remarkable reduction in the number of referrals. And, you know, I would attribute that to the better alignment and the better connection of public services that is driven by the named person policy context, and Highland have been the pioneers in this respect. So I think there's a really very substantial advantage that is demonstrated by that data, which shows the performance of this initiative.
Liz Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you said in the Chamber, and you've repeated it this morning, that obviously any current practice has to be in line with the data protection legislation, also the human rights of 1998. Could I ask you, are you wholly confident that any local authority which had already implemented the named person policy, including the data sharing aspect, has not acted unlawfully?
Yes, because all local authorities must act within the law.
Okay. Secondly, I noticed that you say that when it comes to the overall arching aim of this policy, that the Supreme Court obviously said that it was benign and perfectly legitimate. You also say, however, that it does not require any current policy change. Surely that can't be correct when one aspect of the policy has been ruled unlawful.
I think the point that Liz Smith misses out in that question is the fact that we are putting all of these provisions into statute as new provisions. And the point I was trying to get across in the statement last Thursday is that essentially the government was advancing a new legal framework in which this this policy was to be delivered. And that obviously requires to be compatible with all of the requirements and the tests that the Supreme Court applied to this particular legislation. So it's that legal framework that has to be compatible. When it comes to the individual requirements of the existing arrangements, they must routinely be compatible with the Human Rights Act and the Data Protection Act to enable them to be able to operate satisfactorily.
Cabinet Secretary, this morning we've just revoked part of the Children and Young People's Bill for the time being. Surely that is because part of it has been ruled unlawful. Does that not signify that there has to be some aspect of policy change?
No, that's not my reading of the Supreme Court judgment. The Supreme Court judgment essentially indicates that there is a requirement, and I explained to Parliament why I think the Supreme Court has this in its mind. There has to be a requirement for information sharing, the information sharing provisions to be set out in accordance with law. And I accept that the provisions that we have tried to put in place for the Children and Young People's Act do not fulfil that test, because some of the definitions, which I accept are material in this debate and discussion, are not specified in law. They're specified in guidance. They do not have the authority of law. So I have to make sure they have that authority of law. What the Supreme Court has also said to me is that it is important that we make all of the connections in the legal framework and set them out in accordance with law, and not essentially leave those connections to be made by members of the public. And again, that is what we must do. So I think that the point which the Supreme Court has anchored its judgment on, the point of greatest significance in my view, is their argument that the provisions need to be set out in accordance with law. And that is the challenge to which the government has got to respond. And as I explained in Parliament last Thursday, that type of analysis, that theme of analysis, if I could call it that, from the Supreme Court, has emerged very clearly from the Supreme Court's judgments that postdate the passing of this legislation in 2014 by the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you for that. Can I pick up two points? The first concerns comments that the Supreme Court made about proportionality. It was not just a ruling about the data sharing aspect, they made comments about the proportionality, and they say that it is often likely to be disproportionate, and therefore there was a concern that the named person policy might be intrusive and disproportionate because there was a lack of clarity in the law. Could you tell us how you think that could be addressed?
I think that is largely the same issue that I have referred to, that it is necessary for that to be specified in law. I would take the view that the guidance that has been offered addresses the issue of proportionality. That would have been my position before the Supreme Court judgment, that the guidance that's been put in place essentially reassures people about the question of proportionality and when it would be appropriate for certain things to be done. Now, the Supreme Court has said that must be specified in accordance with law. So that is part of what I think is the job of work that has got to be done here, so that we can be, so that members of the public, as it's not so much that we can be clear, that members of the public can be clear about where how the question of proportionality will be handled, and in accordance with my answer, it will be handled in accordance with law as a consequence of the provisions that we bring forward.
Does that mean, Cabinet Secretary, that there is an acceptance now that the concept of well-being is a problem? It's a nice concept that everybody moves towards, but it's actually not defined properly, and it's certainly not defined in law. Would you accept that because we made that move to well-being instead of the definition of welfare, which is more common in Scots law, that the threshold for intervention was seen to be very much lower, and therefore the professionals who were dealing with named person policy were unsure of the territory on which they found themselves and not sure whether they should intervene or not intervene, because well-being, I have to say, I would be struggling to define it, even given Shinari and all the related information and guidance that goes with that. The logical conclusion, Cabinet Secretary, would be that you would have to define well-being in law. Could you tell us if that's the intention and how you would go about doing that?
I think there's a lot in that question, if I can take time and care to try to explore different parts within that. First of all, and the committee will forgive me if I go over ground that I've already rehearsed with Parliament in my parliamentary statement, but I think it is important that I do it for completeness. I completely disagree with Liz Smith about it being wrong to insert well-being into the judgments as opposed to it all being about welfare. The Supreme Court judgment is crystal clear that the framework around welfare and child protection in law in Scotland is crystal clear. And there is no and they codify it very, very helpfully, codify all of that for us within their judgment. I think the welfare provisions within law are clearly expressed to the satisfaction of the Supreme Court, and that should give members of the public anxious about child protection issues a lot of confidence about our legal framework. But that is not the intention of... If that was our intention, there would be no need to proceed with a named person policy. A named person policy is about, in my view, a lower threshold. It is about taking a preventative intervention. It is about identifying the support that is required to assist young people if they are facing difficulties within our society, to make sure that is available at an earlier stage, so that intervention can be delivered to avoid some of these difficulties becoming more serious, having more serious implications for young people within Scotland. Welfare is really a very, very significant, a welfare concern is a very significant and serious intervention. And we know what it means, and we know what it looks like, and it's tabulated. Well-being is about making sure that we intervene as early as possible to try to avert problems becoming more serious. And that is why I, in answer to the convener earlier on, anchored my view of the role of the named person policy within the GIRFIC agenda. So for me, there is a lower threshold of activity that the named person must be focused upon, because it is about identifying issues that may potentially, if unaddressed, become more serious for young people. That then brings me on to the question of definition. And this is where I think, where my last answer to Liz Smith was trying to address the issue about threshold. I accept that well-being is going to, I think well-being is defined in guidance. We define it in guidance, but I accept that is not in law. So that has to be set out in a fashion that will be robust, and that will pass the test that the Supreme Court have applied to us, that the provisions must be set out in accordance with law. And that will therefore give a clearer legal framework within which the named person policy can be deployed, with consistent with the Children and Young People's Act 2014 and in accordance with the judgment of the Supreme Court. So for me, the arguments around the role of the named person are about ensuring that they can be available to support families, to make the connections that are required, to provide the support and the intervention that is required. But that will be about an awful lot more than welfare. It will be about supporting the well-being of young people within our society.
Okay, thank you. My final point, convener, and thank you for the detailed explanation. I think where I have a very strong difference of opinion on this relates to the fact, and if you listen to those practitioners who are getting very concerned about the implementation of the named person policy. Is it because you are accepting that there is a much lower threshold and therefore well-being is the determining factor? The expectation, because it's obviously a universal policy for every child, the paperwork that goes with that and the assessment that is based on the Shinari indices and all the accompanying guidance is so substantial, because that threshold is so low, that the casework has increased. How would you address that, particularly as you've given a commitment to reduce teachers' workloads in the parliamentary process?
I don't see the necessity for a cottage industry of bureaucracy to be created around about that. What is essential is where there is the requirement for support, that has to be clearly tabulated and understood to enable that support to be delivered to a young person. But the idea that we've got to create a bureaucracy, and I understand the unease of, and it's not just about practitioners, this is about some of the debate that Liz Smith has fuelled as part of the wider political debate. There's no part of this policy proposition that I think is necessary for there to be vast bureaucracies put together summarising an assessment of every single child in the country. That's not the point of this policy. What this is about trusted public servants who we trust every single day of the week with having a role in the nurture and development of our children, be they health visitors or teachers, and we trust every single minute of the day, we trust these people to exercise these responsibilities. We're simply saying that as part of that, these individuals are empowered to require support to be available to assist young people if they require it. Not everybody, because not everybody will require it, but some people will require it, and I want to make sure young people get that support as early as they possibly can do, so that we can avoid the accumulation of difficulties that can undoubtedly happen for young people. So that's why I take a different view about these points, and why I don't, and I tried to address this point in my answer to Mr. Johnson in Parliament last week. I don't want us to think about named person as some compartmentalised extra responsibility. The teachers and the health visitors I talk to in the country are looking at this stuff, looking at their caseload, looking at the young people they're interacting with all the time to assess what are their needs and their requirements. And the named person simply enables those individuals to be empowered to deliver as early as possible what those young people require.
Daniel Johnson, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you. I mean, I think the direction of questioning that we've heard so far this morning, I think, neatly kind of encapsulates the situation we're in. I think we've heard, quite detailed set of questions from Liz Smith about the legal aspects, but actually, we started with the convener's line of questioning, which is actually about perception. And to my mind, while we're here and we've got a pause because of the Supreme Court judgment, actually, the situation we're faced with and that we need to address is one just as much of public perception and indeed trust as it is one of a legal matter. So I welcome the comments you made in your statement about an intense period of engagement, and that the Information Commissioner and the Children's Commissioner will be leading that review. I'd just like to ask you a little bit about the scope of that work. Will it be confined to the legal points raised by the Supreme Court, or will they be seeking to address the wider points around public confidence and trust in this system?
The question of public trust and confidence in the system is a point that I accept unreservedly, and the importance of tackling that is a point I accept unreservedly. And I don't actually think that's the responsibility of the Children's Commissioner or the Information Commissioner or anyone apart from my responsibility. So I accept that responsibility. And it is important that ministers are able to properly and fully build public confidence in what I think is the correct policy. And for that reason, I set out to Parliament last week why I think this is a justifiable and appropriate policy and anchored it within the Gerfic agenda. So I take on that responsibility, and it's for me and for other ministers to make sure that that is fulfilled. I think in relation to the substance of Mr. Johnson's question about scope, what I have in my mind is that I will, as an absolute minimum, address properly and fully the issues that are raised by the Supreme Court judgment, because I think it is important to retain this in perspective. The Supreme Court have said what they've said about information and data sharing. They have not said anything else about the scheme. That is the provision that they have put in place. And that's their requirement, so I have to address that. As part of the work that I will take forward to build public confidence, I will be mindful of what will be helpful in trying to build public confidence, and if there are changes to the scheme and other provisions that are advanced, then I will, of course, give those consideration, as I've indicated to Parliament would be the case.
So can I ask then what the scope of the Information Commission, the Children's Commissioner work will be? Is that something that will be published? And kind of what's the sort of the framework and timeline that this work will be working to?
Well, I, as I said to Parliament, I will undertake this dialogue in the along with the Minister for Childcare and Early Years in the course of the next 3 months. And that will form and frame the decisions that the government then takes about the implementation of the scheme thereafter. I will draw on the input of the Children's Commissioner and the Information Commissioner. I'm not commissioning them to do anything. I'm not entitled to commission them to do anything. I will invite their input and draw on their input and draw on their expertise. And obviously, from their respective specific policy interests, they have got a lot to contribute to this discussion. And I'll listen carefully to their thoughts, as I will to the contribution of many others.
So, I mean, where these two points, I think, come together very clearly is around, I mean, clearly around data sharing, but in particular, the court made suggestions in paragraph 107 about the nature of the information sharing and suggesting that legally binding guidance or support legislation should be provided on when people are told that information is being shared and when consent should be sought. And I think that in particular, I think, brings to a head kind of people's concerns. You know, and as a parent myself, while I support the policy principles of this, you know, that was my sort of nagging concern about things being shared that I don't know about with authorities. So what do you see the direction and the solution to this, and how will that be communicated? And to what extent will this be a voluntary system? Because I think if I have one area of where I feel there's a lack of clarity, it's a regard how voluntary will participation and indeed communication with the named person be, and how binding will their actions be on parents?
The first thing I'd say in response to Mr. Johnson's question is that his reference to section 107 essentially brings out some of the issues around consent. And, you know, I consider that to be a material issue that has to be addressed as part of satisfactorily addressing the Supreme Court judgment. So to go back to his previous question, what is in scope? I consider that to be in scope for the work that has got to be undertaken. Mr. Johnson then asked me to go on to set out what I consider to be the answers to this question, and if the committee will forgive me, it's slightly premature for me to be providing all of the answers when I'm about to embark on a three-month intensive dialogue process to establish exactly how that might be undertaken. But I don't say that to be flippant. It's to, you know, I have to give this due thought and consideration to make sure these issues are properly addressed, because I want to address them satisfactorily in terms of the Supreme Court. It's a responsibility I take immensely seriously. I think the final point I would say is a general observation about the named person policy. The Supreme Court make the comment that it is possible within the provisions that we had put in place for members of the public to not participate in the named person policy, but they make the point that it's not perhaps as clear as it could be. And that, I think, is part of the difficulties we've had around the communication of this policy and the acceptance of the policy and the fact that it's caused unease among some members of the public as part of the wider political debate. So I consider these to be issues that are very much in scope to be addressed as part of the work that I take forward.
Finally, can I just pick up on some of the sort of the final comments that you made in response to Liz Smith, in particular about kind of quote unquote that not wanting to create a cottage industry of support. I take on board your points, and I agree with you that our you know, our teachers and our health visitors, and indeed everyone that works with children, needs to be focused on their holistic, you know, well-being and supporting them in those terms. However, in the discussions that I've been having with teachers and with health visitors, it's not just that concern about what might happen, but where this policy has been implemented, there already is a very substantial amount of work that has been created. And I have been talking to teachers in schools where teaching assistants are essentially working now full time on dealing with the information coming in. You know, likewise, talking to health visitors, you know, the sort of automatic triggering of information from nursery schools when certain kind of situations happen at nursery means that they are going to have a very substantial amount of information coming their way when health visitors, I understand it, have no administrative support. So while I understand that the holistic nature and intent behind this, and I in many ways I agree with it, the reality is I think bureaucracy is created, work is created, and we need to resource that. And I think, if I may say, I think just because we don't wish to create a cottage industry of support doesn't mean that work isn't already being created in quite a substantial way.
I think I reiterate what I said in my response to Liz Smith, that I have no desire to create a cottage industry here, and that will be very much in my mind as to how we take forward the implementation of the policy and its delivery at an operational level. Let me just try to work my way through some of the issues that are relevant here. Our health visitors and teachers it's part of their role and responsibility to be looking out for the well-being of young people in over whom they have a duty of care. That's what they're doing every day of the week. That's what I see in schools. It's what I see health visitors doing around the country. So we're not asking health visitors and teachers to do anything here that they're not already doing in terms of looking out for the well-being. If I can, it's maybe not the most precise parliamentary term, but I think members will understand the point I'm making. What we want to make sure the named person has at their disposal is when they have a concern and they want to do something to make sure a child receives the support that they need to receive, they are able to get that support. That there's a point of contact where they can go to obtain that support. And that's not always clear within the system. And I made the point to Parliament last week, members of the public come to me to ask me to get the public services connected for them, not to say how wonderfully connected the public services are often. Now, I accept that if I mandate in this system that there's got to be, let's say, a weekly report filled out on every single child in a school about their well-being, I accept that will be a cottage industry of bureaucracy. I'm not going to ask for that to be the case. But what I do want to make sure is that there can be proper opportunity for professionals in whom we already place our trust to support and nurture our children are able to have access to the resources and the support to make sure that we address the needs of young people.
Okay.
Hey, Colin, and then followed by Tavish.
Thank you, Mayor. Cabinet Secretary, very early on in the discussion, you mentioned about the rather extreme positions sometimes taken in relation to named person. And in part, a few minutes ago, you partly answered my question I was going to be asking, which is many of the elements, surely, of named person already in place, as you correctly said. You've got teachers, you've got health visitors and so on that perform in support of children and would carry out any reporting of anything they saw that was not up to what they would expect. Surely the named person is simply a joining up of processes, a putting in place of good practice.
It is that, but it's also the empowering of individuals who are key contact points with young people, with the ability to connect the public services to deliver interventions that will support those young people and address their difficulties. So it's essentially a resource that's available to individuals and families to support them in their times of difficulty and to ensure that those needs are adequately and fully addressed as a consequence.
Would there then be a need for an escalation process within each council to be able to accommodate the issues as they come up?
Well, undoubtedly, there will be measures that need to be taken in individual circumstances to meet the needs of young people. So, quite clearly, there might be a need if a named person is finding it difficult to make the connections of services that are required, there may be a need to seek further support within organisations. But crucially, the named person policy will empower individuals in the front line of our public services to be able to fulfil that role.
The escalation process presumably would not be new. It should be what's in place already. And teachers and others involved with children should be using it already. So presumably that's not an additional requirement.
No, these processes exist already within public authorities and would be followed as part of this process.
What after the engagement exercise will be in law that's not currently in law?
We will. It's a difficult question for me to give a comprehensive answer to, but essentially what I have to do is to make sure that the provisions that the Supreme Court believe need to be codified in law are the ones that are codified in law at a very minimum. So I would consider that to be the information sharing provisions, the definition of the approach to well-being, and the definition of circumstances and arrangements around the necessity or otherwise to obtain consent for any particular intervention. Those would be three elements that I could foresee being in law, but I have to be mindful of the test that the Supreme Court have placed. That, and if I go back to the thinking behind their judgment, which is that these issues need to be codified in accordance with law, I have to be mindful of the need to satisfactorily address that.
So, thank you. So those three areas, at least, that are currently in guidance would then, or in future, at some stage next year, become law.
Subject to the agreement of Parliament.
Well, indeed, subject to the agreement. And there may be some areas that also come up in the context of the engagement exercise you're undertaking. You haven't closed your mind, I think, as you said to colleagues earlier on. There may be some other areas as well. Can I just ask a couple of specific questions about the Supreme Court judgment? In 84, in paragraph 84 of their judgment, they said, there is no statute requirement, qualified or otherwise, to inform the parents of a child about the sharing of information. Presumably that's exactly your point. That one will be taken care of by. And so the other one I asked you about last week is 95, which probably as a parent, it's a bit like Daniel Johnson, as a parent was the one that gave me most concern, in which the beginning of 95 is about parents will be given the impression that they must accept the advice or services which they are offered. Their failure to cooperate will be taken as an evidence of risk of harm. That, I must confess, that's the one that gives me the most worries, not just as a parliamentarian, but much more as a parent. Will that be addressed, Mr. Swinney?
I think this clause 95 of the of the judgment essentially relates to a point which has been a material point in the debate up until now as to whether or not it is possible for families to decide not to engage with the named person or not to pursue those issues. Now, you know, I've expressed the position that I believe the existing provisions that the government and Parliament put in place enables that to be the case. Obviously, the Supreme Court, in their analysis, questioned whether that is as clear as it could be. Now, so I come at this discussion from the point of view that I think families must be able to say, we don't want to participate here. That's a point of consent that is important. If that is not clear, and I take from Clause 95, the Supreme Court do not believe it to be clear, then that has to be addressed.
Thank you. The final question I really wanted to ask is, when these three aspects and others that you may or may not choose to bring before Parliament at some later stage become law, you will, I'm sure, recognise that if you're a pupil support teacher in any of our secondary schools, then it is a different thing altogether from the voluntary structure that used to be the case in Highland that, as you rightly said, has been effective, and I've had those discussions as well and understand that. I've got a son at a school in the Highlands, so I know about that, from it being in law. It just is manifestly different for a pupil support teacher because they are sitting there with a statute on their desk, which they must then implement. And is that not, in all this codification that we're now going to have to go through because of this judgment, the point that I take you making about the cottage industry bureaucracy and that kind of thing, it is a different thing when the cottage industry is driven by law as opposed to the ability to say we're not going to do that because actually we make these arrangements work perfectly well because it's a voluntary structure. Isn't that the bind we're now all in?
I don't think that's the case at all. I think what the opportunity of the response to the Supreme Court judgment that is available to us is that we can actually address the issues of clarity so that we have in place a framework that is easier to understand and more comprehensible by everybody who has to operate the system, be they a teacher or a health visitor, or be they a parent, to have clarity from a parental perspective of their rights and the wider framework within which this is operating.
So that, I take that, but I suppose that does therefore logically mean in the context of Liz Smith's very earlier questions that the definition of well-being and all the related factors that come in under that are therefore going to have to be crystal clear, or are we not, I know you'll say this could or could not happen, but are we not therefore going to have another court question about the clarity of that stage? Because that's a bit that many see as most uncertain.
But I think the... I actually don't agree with that last point that Mr. Scott made, because I think the definition of well-being is clear, but I accept it's not in law. That's the difference. Now, colleagues might not think it's possible to define well-being. I think it's perfectly possible to define well-being. We define many, many things in life, but the well-being of our young people, our children, is to me something that's perfectly definable, but I accept it's not in law. And that's the hard point the Supreme Court put to us. And it does, in relation to the questions that Liz Smith raised earlier on, it is, well-being is different from welfare. We know what welfare looks like. The Supreme Court have done an excellent job in setting out what welfare is and what is triggered by it, and it's defined. But I suppose, to be consistent about this, the Supreme Court are able to do that because it's defined in law. And that's the point I'm accepting. It's not been addressed by the Children and Young People's Act 2014, and it must be addressed to satisfy the Supreme Court.
Okay. Thank you.
Ross Thompson, followed by Joanne Law.
Thank you very much, convener. It's just for a point of absolute clarity.
is the scheme that was introduced in Highland in 2008 exactly the same as the scheme that would have been introduced on the 31st of August this year?
No, because there's a particular legal framework that accompanies the Children and Young People's Act 2014, which was not enforced in 2008.
Okay. And if so, it's a no, why have the Scottish Government sort of kept using Highland, therefore, as the example for all local authorities across Scotland to follow in particular?
Well, for a number of very good reasons, not least of which the application of this scheme in Highland has reduced the number of referrals to the Children's Reporter for Children in the Highlands from 2,335 in 2007 to 744 in 2013, a drop of 68%, and there has been a sustained reduction of 15 to 20% in the number of looked after children. I think that is because Highland have been taking an early intervention approach on these questions. And like many things in Scotland, good ideas happen in one part of the country and they don't always happen in all parts of the country and they don't always get implemented on a systemic basis. But improvements in the support and nurture of children of that magnitude are benefits that I think need to be shared across the whole country and required across the whole country.
Following on from Liz Smith's line of questioning round about whether local authorities have been acting lawfully or not following the Supreme Court judgment, I see that a number of local authorities are proceeding still. Some have taken their guidance off their websites. There still seems to be a bit of confusion in some local authorities. Can you give a guarantee again that they are acting lawfully, and what steps is the Cabinet Secretary going to take to provide clarity to local authorities?
Well, much as though it's been alleged for many years, I do not run every local authority in the country. At this moment, Tavish Scott is not allowed to make sedentary interventions. Local authorities are self-governing bodies that must take their own decisions. We provide guidance, and we have done so. But each local authority must take its own decisions.
And finally, Cabinet Secretary, as part of the engagement process that there's going to be, will you invite professionals along like Maggie Mellor, the SBTC, and even No to Name Person to be part of that engagement process and consultation? And will you yourself be attending any sessions with parents and practitioners to hear their concerns?
Yes, I will be attending events personally, as will the Minister for Early Learning and Childcare on the Saturday. I'll be meeting with the National Parent Forum for Scotland, who I'm not quite sure what they'll want to discuss with me, but I'm certainly be happy to discuss this issue and any other issue with them on Saturday as part of my ongoing engagement with the National Parent Forum. I'll be very active in this discussion. I'll be listening carefully. I will do that personally, and I will absorb the points that are made to me. In relation to other organisations, I'm going to engage as widely as I can, but I'm not making a disrespectful point here, but I'll make it in fashion. No to Name Person sort of doesn't want to have the named person. So there's a bit of a fundamental policy disagreement there. I'm very happy to engage with people who will accept the principled arguments that I set out to Parliament last week about why we have gone down this route. I'm very happy to engage with people who will respect the democratic will of Parliament, because Parliament has legislated for this. And we shouldn't forget that point. But Mr. Thompson, I hope, will forgive me if I don't engage in conversations about people who want to make sure we don't have a named person policy. We've got a fundamental disagreement there. And, you know, the Supreme Court set out the areas of our legislation. The part of the challenge of those who took the legal challenge to the Supreme Court was to bring this policy to an end. And they failed. Supreme Court did not support them. So I've got the weight of the Supreme Court on my side on that question, and I've got the weight of Parliament on my side on that question. What I don't demur from in any way is the need to adequately and properly and fully address the issues of the Supreme Court judgment. But I'm very happy to engage widely about all of these questions. But I think Mr. Thompson will understand my perspective that I don't see the value in discussing the question in principle, because I've made it very clear to Parliament, and I have parliamentary authority to support me, that this policy will be implemented.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I appreciate your answer and response. I suppose just as a gentle reminder that obviously no two named persons represent the weight of parental opinion as well. But my question actually is for clarification, will there be a consultation paper at the end of the 3 months as well?
I'll give consideration to what follows at the end of the period of consultation. Obviously, there will be proposals that will have to be set out to Parliament, and I don't yet know what form they will take, so I'll reserve my position on what shape and form that will take.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm interested in your position saying that you're not going to have the discussion, the question in principle. I recognise that you can promote that principle, but I would say to you, in all seriousness, there are people involved who are concerned about the named person, who have their children's interests at heart. They're not maybe actively involved with this organisation, but they are genuinely concerned and need to be persuaded. And I'm not sure, with respect to you, that they will be persuaded by an argument which says, well, we've decided this and we can't be shifted on it. Because there are people I know who are genuinely concerned, people who have fought every day for their children, people with children with disabilities, who are concerned about this. And I'm not sure if closing the door to that conversation with them is going to help a policy which, in principle, I probably, in large part, support. So I wonder whether, I suppose the question I'm interested in now, and I did work in this field, I worked in this kind of, this is what I did before I came in here, when some might say I worked for a living. And therefore, I get absolutely the need to recognise early the signs that there are problems and intervene early. But what I'm being told by people who work in schools, by third sector organisations who work in our communities, people who work in social work, that the supports are not there in the way they were in the past. So my concern and the question I put to you is, to what extent have you assessed the reality that the named person will be able to access supports? Classroom assistants are not there in the same numbers, attendance officers, Homelinks teachers, behaviour support, education support, supports within communities for children's organisations to work with families. These are all reducing because of financial pressures. And so we could end up, we were having an academic argument about how you ensure that children are identified in order to access supports, but the supports aren't there.
First of all, I think I just try to address the early parts of John Lamont's question. And, I have to, in looking at this issue, and I've looked at it very carefully, I have to be mindful of what the Supreme Court judgment actually said. And it raised particular issues that we have to address. But it tested the entire legal framework and judged that there were a certain number of issues that we had to address, and the government will do so. If the Supreme Court had said, this contradicts basic rights, then obviously there would have been we'd be in a very different situation today. But they didn't say that. So I then, having had that tested in the last court that it could be tested in within the United Kingdom, we have got the ability to take forward this legislation. And that's what Parliament has decided. Parliament has legislated for this, and I support it. I have no reason to believe there is not a parliamentary majority to support the legislation today. But regardless of that, the legislation has been passed by Parliament. and I've got a specific challenge to address the issues of the Supreme Court. So I'm not taking an arbitrary stance in the points that I'm raising with Ross Thompson. I'm simply making the point that if there are people who are in a campaign organisation implacably opposed to named person, I'm not sure I see the value of a conversation between me and them. However, the people that Joanne Lamont is talking about are probably the same people that Daniel Johnson is talking about, who are parents who are looking at this thinking, wait a minute, what does this represent? I'm not certain about this. So I've got to win the argument with those individuals. I've got to be persuasive to those individuals. And I can't do that by saying, well, actually, I'm not sure if we're going to have a named person. You know, I believe in my heart that this is the right thing to do, because I believe, for many of the same reasons that Joanne Lamont, although with very different personal experiences before we, in our working lives, before we came to Parliament, for many of the same reasons, and from the body of my constituency experience as well as a Member of Parliament over the last 19 years, that this type of policy intervention will help to improve the well-being and the opportunities of young people in our society. So I've got to make that case, and I've got to make it in a persuasive way and accept that responsibility. That's what I accepted in my answer to Daniel Johnson. The second part of Joanne Lamont's question is material in all of this, that if we are saying to young people and their families in Scotland, look, if you have difficulties, this person will be a point of contact for you to be able to access the resources to be able to support you. We've got to be able to deliver on that. So that's an obligation that we have. And that's why in very challenging financial circumstances, we have taken the decisions that we have taken to try to support the provision of wider interventions to support the closure of the attainment gap through the attainment challenge, for example. And that's what dominates a large number of the other responsibilities that I carry as Education Secretary. Some of those issues, of course, will be challenging for us. We saw in the data last week, which was discussed at First Minister's Question Time last week, the substantial rise in mental health referrals that have taken place amongst young people. And I accept that the waits for mental health service interventions are too long, but part of that is explained by the fact that we've had a 30% increase in 1 year in mental health referrals. And that is something, that's a factor and a trend that we've got to properly and fully address as a government, to make sure young people can receive the support to which they are entitled. So Joanne Lamont asks a fair question and puts a fair challenge to me, that it is important that we have in place the support that can address any issues that are raised with us by as a consequence of this policy approach.
Does that mean that you would consider looking at more generally local government budgets? Because it's not just that it's an increase in mental health referrals, which this has been discussed. I would contend that early intervention with some of our young people would prevent these issues then being referred as mental health issues, because it may be circumstances in the family. And I wonder whether, would you commit at least to looking at the extent to which the services around a child, which I believe fundamentally make a difference in terms of closing the attainment gap, but critically are also important in terms of the issues that you identify, that there is an exercise in actually looking at what's happening in our schools, in our communities. Third sector organisations have already flagged this up to me, around the resources that are available to them to work within our communities with families that need support. I mean, would you commit to look to reviewing that? Because I do think if you look at that honestly and with some rigour, I do think it will then mean we'll need to redirect resources towards local government that have been directed away from it.
I look at all of these questions habitually. They are part and parcel of the work that I take forward. I accept that the fulfilment, the potential of every young person in Scotland is not just determined by what goes on between 9 and 3:30 in school. It's a much wider set of interventions in which local authorities will be significantly involved. So these are questions that I look at on a sustained basis and which are reflected in the government's policy agenda, and we continue to look at those.
Thank you.
The Cabinet Secretary talked a wee bit about the policy run out in Highland, and I know some of my colleagues have mentioned that as well, but I think it's very, very encouraging to hear that the results of that have led to less referrals to the reporter and less child protection referrals, which I think is the point. It's leading to less state intervention, which is one of the criticisms of the policy. Do you think, Mr. Swinney, that if the policy gets the approval of Parliament and is rolled out across the country, that the results will be similar in other authority areas?
I think there's an important point in Mr. McGregor's question, which I should have referred to in my answer to Joanne Lamont, which is about the fact that earlier intervention has the potential to reduce the long-term demand on public services. And that's what the Highland data suggests. So in terms of the sustainability of public services, actually going through exercising the named person policy responsibility and intervening at an earlier stage potentially reduces the caseload and the volume of activity that is required to be sustained in the medium to the longer term. So there is, I think, a real benefit arising out of that approach, and that's one that I think is a product of the good example we've seen in Highland.
Could also come back and to follow up on a point that Tavish Scott made as well. Tavish raised concerns or possible concerns about whether parents and families could opt in and out of the named person scheme. If it is the case that people can opt in and out, what would be the process then for individuals who have opted out where there has been an identified level of risk by the primary sectors? So would that not just lead back to the child protection process being initiated?
Ultimately, we'll have to address this point, we'll have to look at the questions of consent that the Supreme Court have properly put in front of us. And as part of that, that will codify the approach that we take in relation to the participation of individuals within the named person policy. There is and Mr. McGregor will be conversant with this from his former role before he came into Parliament, his employment as a social worker before he came into Parliament. There is a very clearly codified approach to child protection, and the Supreme Court marshalled that for us in their judgment. So obviously if there is an assessment of risk, that is tangibly undertaken within the child protection system, and appropriate action can be taken within that context. I'm anxious to make the distinction between those interventions. Child protection interventions are very much about interventions at a high level of risk. What the named person policy is about being an early intervention resource that is available to to young people and their families to be able to seek assistance to try to remedy issues before those become more challenging issues for those individuals. And if we can strike the right balance in all of this, I think it will have the effect of addressing the point in Mr. McGregor's earlier question, which is about the opportunity to reduce the long-term demand on public services because we are intervening earlier before problems become more acute.
And I suppose just as a final point, convener, thanks to the Cabinet Secretary for bringing up my previous employment, and I would say that I think that in my own experience, which was quite a number of years working in the child protection front, I think that this legislation will be of great benefit if it is approved through Parliament. And I suppose that the point I was picking up on, from what Tavish Scott had made, I probably didn't phrase it right. I was raising a concern if that part of the legislation isn't there, rather than raising that as an outright criticism. But I think that's just for a point. Thanks.
And then finally, Richard.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm really interested in the work being done around engagement with public petitioners and those that may have concerns. You've alluded to particularly the concerns that parents have who might have had some misleading information around the whole tabloid journalism around this, and that's obviously an issue that we're going to have to deal with. But no one in their questions has actually talked about advocacy for children, because one of the things that I hear most when we're talking about child protection is lack of advocacy for children. So there are children out there right now who have a named person and who rely on that named person, whether it be in the Highlands or whether it be, you know, in all but name, a named person like a guidance teacher. How are you going to engage with those children and give them the reassurance that that support's going to be there during this process, and also that their views are going to be taken into account? Because I think that's what's been lacking this morning, is actually talking about getting the engagement with the children that are going to be affected by this legislation.
We have a number of different organisations in Scotland who are tremendously well connected with young people in Scotland. And as part of my plan, I want to work with those organisations to try to have some of that dialogue. I think it's, you know, if the Scottish Government wheels up to have a consultation with young people, I think it might be more productive if we do that through under the auspices of other organisations. Now, I've yet to come to specific proposals about that, but I'll discuss that with some of the very good organisations that we have that foster and encourage dialogue with young people within Scotland to make sure that we can have this conversation and can understand fully and properly their perspective. So that's just as important in the exercise as it is to have the proper and effective engagement with parents and other stakeholders as part of this process.
Back to my earlier point about the sort of tabloid journalism around this, I mean, it's certainly been very damaging, and I have to declare a certain amount of interest. My husband's a guidance teacher and effectively says he's effectively being a named person, as is. Around the language that's been in tabloids, around sort of state snoopers, very, very offensive to a lot of people doing very, very hard work. I mean, what message have you got for people like my husband, like guidance teachers, people who've already been named person, who've been subjected to this kind of language?
I think, obviously, I made clear in Parliament last week what I consider to be the debilitating effect of some of this commentary on the individuals who we rely on every day of the week to provide nurture and support to our children and young people in Scotland. And we rely on them every single day of the week to do that. So I very much value the contribution of these individuals. I appreciate that it has not been a pleasant experience for them to see their work labelled in this fashion. And I commit myself, as I said in response to Mr. Johnson, to trying to change some of those attitudes and some of those perspectives as a consequence of the leadership that I give to communicating what I think is an extremely valuable and important policy for supporting the well-being of young people in Scotland.
And just a final question, which you may not have an answer for yet, but one of the things that came when I was speaking to people about this who had, you know, were supportive in principle of this, but just had some niggling concerns, maybe coming into what Mr. Scott was saying, and of course what Fulton was saying about whether you can opt in or opt out of an named person. And I personally agree with Fulton. I don't think that's an ideal situation at all. However, if a child has an issue with their named person, if the child wants to change their named person for whatever reason, that they're not comfortable, is that something that could be looked at as well?
That's possible within the existing scheme that was legislated for. That is possible for it to be done. Indeed, I think I answered a question from Mr. Scott on one of the earlier occasions that this was discussed in Parliament, or maybe an intervention actually, to clarify that that was in fact the case. If families wish to, you know, wish to have a different named person for some individual reason. So that is, you know, that can be taken forward as part of the existing framework.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, and we'll finish off with Richard Lockhead.
Thanks. Just to ask about the plans for communicating with parents. I mean, I've been contacted by several people over the last year or two as a constituency MSP, and people have genuine concerns that need to be addressed. Others tend to couch their concerns and wider concerns about the SNP government, a whole range of issues perhaps. So There is some hysteria out there and misinformation, as we're all aware. So how did the government plan to actually communicate in a clear, articulate, simple way that people can understand with parents as to what the truth is?
Well, as a long-serving, experienced former Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Lockhead will understand that that obligation rests pretty firmly on my shoulders. So I've accepted throughout this whole process that we've got a significant challenge to build public confidence in this policy. And I intend to do that because I think it's the right policy. But we need to explain the arguments for the named person, the resource that it will represent to families and young people within Scotland, and the advantage that it conveys for those individuals. Now, obviously, we're communicating that in an atmosphere when many other much more negative messages are being communicated, and that is a challenge for the government to address those issues. But I reassure Mr. Lockhead that that will be done energetically and emphatically by ministers.
In that case, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for a very useful session this morning. Thank you very much. We will suspend for a few minutes to allow the next panel to take their seats. Business is a panel on attainment. This is the third of six overview panels following on from the two panels on skills and post-16 education last week. These sessions will inform consideration of our future work programme, and the overview will end with a session with the Cabinet Secretary. Before welcoming witnesses, can I begin by putting on record my thanks to all those who organised and took part in the meeting we held in Stirling on early years in school education on the 30th of August. The committee spoke to a number of people with a real breadth of personal experiences, including children and young people, parents, teachers and support staff, and people working in community initiatives. Meeting these people has proved a valuable insight and context for this overview session. Today, I'd like to welcome Lindsay Law, Vice Convener of the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, Graham Logan, Strategic Director of Education Scotland, Jamie Petrie, Head Teacher, Broomhouse Primary School, and Paul Clancy, Head of Secondary Education, Dundee City Council, which I understand is one of the 9 challenge authorities. We're going to go straight into questions, and I'd like to start off by asking you a question regarding the yesterday's governance review. I wonder if the panel have any comments on how the review will impact on the attainment. Could we start with you?
I read the Cabinet Secretary's speech, and at SPTC we welcome the statement that no child will be forced to fail at 11 and we won't move to selection into grammar schools. We think that's the right choice. We think the OECD report that shows that Scotland has an inclusive, comprehensive education system is the right thing to continue with. We know that the data show that there's an attainment gap, but we don't often take the time to express what that means and think about what it means from a parent's perspective. To put it another way, if you live in Scotland and you're poor, your children are likely to do worse at school than children from families who are richer. If you have a daughter, she's likely to perform more poorly in maths. And if you have a son, he's likely to perform more poorly in literacy and in reading. You can send your child to the same school as a child who comes from a richer family, and your child is likely to do worse than another child. The Cabinet Secretary says poverty is not destiny, and we agree with that statement, but sadly, for too many children in Scotland just now, poverty is shaping their destiny. It's wrong. It's a waste of potential of child after child rooted in inequality in our society. A parent would naturally turn to school for answers. However, the quality of teaching in schools is clearly not the underlying issue when you have children in the same class as other children who do not perform as well, boys in the same class as girls who don't attain the same levels of reading. This is one of the reasons that we are resistant to gathering national attainment data to either publish school league tables or enable them to be created, because it's a very blunt instrument that doesn't allow parents to truly see the work being done in schools.
Thanks, Mr. Doyle. Good morning, colleagues. I think in terms, very specifically, in terms of the governance review, I think this is a great opportunity for us to all engage in a really constructive debate about what is the best way of supporting education in Scotland as we move forward. If we think of the vision of excellence and equity and really making the breakthrough that we want to make here about that cycle of poverty impacting on attainment, what are the best supports and surrounds around schools? So I think it's a great opportunity for schools and for teachers and for all our partners to really think afresh about what is the best support. If we think of the engagement between teacher and pupil, what is the best support around that to drive improvement and to make the breakthrough? So I think it's a great opportunity, and I hope we'll have a very constructive, lively debate about the way forward in Scotland to support improvement.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning, colleagues. Yeah, from a head teacher's perspective, from a school in Edinburgh, I think the statement about schools having more power to make decisions within schools for what their requirements are is a very welcome statement for us. At schools, we spend all our time thinking about how to get children included and how to raise their attainment and get them into positive destinations. It's our core business. It's what we do. So it's really encouraging to hear that we're going to be part of that wider debate in how to make that actually happen in schools. So again, I welcome that part. I think the part about poverty shouldn't be what defines a child is a very important part of that. In my particular school context, we have a number of people in poverty who show a lot of aptitude and skills within school, and it's how we can then work together in clusters to put them in a positive destination. So that's my views.
Good morning. I would agree. I think it's timely that there's a review of the governance arrangements for education in Scotland. It's a small country. I think we have quite a complicated system, in my view, when you actually look at the number of parties involved, both at national level and at local level. I particularly welcome the idea of trying to increase parental work within schools and parental governance arrangements for schools. We've worked very hard over the years to involve our parents, and they are involved to a certain extent, maybe more in some schools than others. But I think the whole idea of bringing parents more into the centre of what actually goes on in the life of the schools will be important. I'd also want to make a comment on leadership, because I don't think it's just the autonomy of schools. Schools have, through Curriculum for Excellence and through devolved school management, quite a degree of autonomy now. What's important is the leadership and making sure the leadership is there to actually use this to take things forward. I think we need to look at bureaucracy to ensure that teachers and schools are concentrating on the things that matter. And we need to make sure that we have a leadership system that builds practitioners and head teachers so they are able to lead. So it's not just systemic change we actually require. I think we require cultural change so that communities, parents and head teachers together are empowering young people in systems. So it's not just systemic, it's got to be something to do with the culture, because I think we have things with our systems just now that allow that kind of autonomy, although it's not always taken. Although there are examples where it does happen in Scotland, but that's something we think we need to have more widespread.
Thank you very much for that. I may welcome back in at a later stage, but Daniel?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for coming along and providing us with your views. I think the challenge around attainment and the sort of equality and equity issues for all the children, I think, go to the very heart of why so many of us are here. And certainly, I think the point about, you know, your background not being, you know, determining your destiny is fundamental. So I think there's three elements to this. One is recognising the issue. I think secondly is understanding it and having the right measures in place. And then lastly, making sure that we've got the right resources in place to tackle it. And I'm sure other members in the committee will talk about the measures, but I would quite like to talk about the resource. And I think it takes a broad range of approaches and a child-centred focus to tackle these issues. And I think, critically, I think that it's not just down to teachers. I think that the broad range of staff and support staff in schools are vitally important. I'm just wondering if I could get just some initial reflections on that point from the panel.
Graham, do you want to start?
Yes, thanks very much, Mr. Johnston. I absolutely agree from our evidence in working with schools and local authorities that this requires all partners around children and families to work together. And in fact, some of the really innovative practice we're seeing through the Scottish Attainment Challenge is teachers working alongside, for example, speech and language therapists in the early years, family support workers, our partners in community learning and development, and in the third sector. So I think the best plans that have emerged from individual schools and from local authorities have taken that very joined up approach to look across the services for children. If I can just give you one example, we know that children coming into primary one aged five have a difference in their actual words that they know. So between the most and least deprived children in Scotland, there's an average of 15-month difference in their vocabulary. So through the Scottish Attainment Challenge, we've got some schools really radically looking at the curriculum in primary one, primary two, and changing that to be much more literacy rich to close that vocabulary gap as early on as possible so that the gap doesn't continue to widen. And as I say, we're also seeing speech and language therapists working in classrooms with primary one teachers. So absolutely agree that we need all partners to work together, and that's some of the early insights from the Attainment Challenge in localities across Scotland. We are seeing that happening.
Jamie Petter.
Yeah, again, to pass on Graham's point there, I think for us in schools, it's very interesting that the early level curriculum for excellence starts in preschool nursery year. Preschool nursery year is not a compulsory part of the education system. So what we tend to find, we spend a lot of time in schools making sure that our parents understand that they need to get their children to all their nursery sessions, because they're already in preschool starting that curriculum for excellence process, of which we're then asked to determine whether a child has achieved the level at the end of primary one. For our children and our parents, sometimes it's a challenge for them to get their children into nursery every day for every session. We generally find that the children that do come in for every session have far more opportunity to succeed as they go through the school, rather than if they're missing a good part of nursery education. They've missed a lot of what they need to be able to do when they move into primary one. Therefore, in primary one, they're already falling behind slightly. We have intervention programmes. You know, we as schools always look to many different partners. So, you know, within my school, we have a partnership with the health service in a program called Word Boost, and that is precisely to address what Graham is saying. You know, it's well known that, you know, a lot of our children that come through from poverty, you know, you've put it in a context of 15 months. For me, I quite like the analogy that it's 2 million words they've heard less than a child who is read to from birth onwards. You know, that's already a massive gap that we're trying to fill in schools. And we have lots of programs that we put in place to do that. In order for those programs to work, of course, we have to upskill the teachers. And again, you know, with the nature of teaching being as it is, we're asking our staff to be skilled in lots of different areas. And sometimes the concern for me is that, you know, within that, we're asking them to be skilled in this area. It's how do we get a system within initial teacher education where teachers coming into the profession can see how these skills are transferable in other curricular areas and other parts of education as well.
Thank you. Paul?
I think it's a really good question in terms of the getting the resource right, and it's a fundamental point for us. I think the attainment challenge has provided an opportunity to bring in a bank of resources in an immediate way to respond to these problems. What's been interesting for me as I've looked at that is the balance between what we require on the teaching side and what we require on the support staff side. And I was really actually interested in some of the evidence from RAPLOCH, where those who were providing the evidence were talking about the extension of teachers' role into the social sphere. And I understand what they're meaning. They're talking about moving away from just traditional teaching, picking other aspects of nurture and care. And I suppose the question that we asked in Dundee was, it doesn't always have to be teachers to do this. And it's getting that balance between teaching staff and support staff right. And predominantly, our aim is to ensure that teachers are well trained so they can concentrate on the role of teaching. They've certainly got to nurture, they've got to show care, but let's concentrate on the pedagogy and the teaching and work cooperatively in an organised way with extended ranges of support staff within our core provision to be able to provide these other areas of coverage. And I think that's been the issue over the years, that we've brought support staff in and the voluntary sector, third sector, but it's often just been at the margins and we've not been able to sustain it into the core because the funding hasn't been there for it. It's only been there on a temporary basis. So if you want to get that balance right for producing good, sound, social, health, emotional well-being, it's getting the balance of support staff, the skill set right between that and your teaching staff, and then making sure it's funded as part of the core. So certainly within our attainment challenge bid, which we were successful in receiving, it's mostly on the support staff side that we've strengthened areas. So it's speech and language therapists, it's school and family development workers. And again, I picked up from the RAPLOCH evidence that families wanted to have key workers, family workers, people that they could rely on. So that the answer to this is not just more teachers, it's high quality learning and teaching, but balancing it properly with support staff resources that are funded as part of a core organisation.
Surround families and go beyond education are really vital in helping parents and families engage with education. The barriers that poverty raises are not always immediately apparent and don't stop at the school gate. In fact, they start well before. It's hard to read to a toddler if your own literacy is challenged. It's hard to provide a child with quiet space to do homework if your home is cramped and damp and unsafe. It's hard to provide food in the school holidays if you don't have free school meals, and school holidays become a challenge to be dreaded rather than an enriching time for children. It's hard to provide extracurricular activities for children if you can't afford it, and it travel times increase to those activities if you don't have a car. Now, those are all things that are out with the bounds of teachers to solve, but absolutely need to be addressed to allow parents and children to engage with education. If the school asks for money and the parent can't provide, that becomes a barrier to a conversation between the parent and the school, because we still have a stigma associated with poverty in this country. And that stigma creates a stereotype, which creates anxiety and causes parents and children to disengage with school. So absolutely, the entirety of support surrounding a family is absolutely crucial in allowing a parent and children to engage with school.
Thank you. I think that's really interesting. It's great to have such a coherent set of responses. But I think, you know, Paul Clancy, I think you made a very good point about kind of the need to be balanced and having sufficient resource and specifically in terms of kind of additional professionals in the school, you know, to support the work that the teachers do. Maybe just like to just follow up on that with both Lindsay Law and Jamie Petrie, you know, as people who are kind of right in there, you know, and I hate these cliches, but at the coalface, not that children should be going anywhere near coalfaces. I mean, do you feel that support's there right now? You know, and what do you feel the direction of travel is, and where would you like to be in terms of that level of non-teaching professional support in schools?
I think it's definitely there. It's the case of sourcing and finding and having access to it. You know, within my school, we have play therapy, art therapy, we have parental groups, we've got Bernardo's, we have all the services that we can possibly engage with. And I suppose that the key ethos for schools, and certainly for schools like mine, is that every single person that works in that school, particularly the teachers and the staff that work with the children in the classroom, need to know everything about that child, everything about their needs, everything about what will make them be able to achieve and attain at school. Once we've got that ethos within the school, it's then the professionals that can tell fairly quickly if something is not right in that child's education, whether it's any part of the Shinari wheel, whether it's nurtured or safe. The teachers then have the confidence to act upon that, and then when they act upon that, it's then knowing which services are available for them. Now, I think, you know, my concern about having lots of different people in the school, you know, when we look at our pupil support assistants, for whom they have a significant responsibility to work with children for whom education is challenging and can, as a result of that, be violent, they can be quite difficult to manage. You know, these are people that are earning a very, very small salary for the job that they are doing. And I do fear that we're putting an awful lot of responsibility onto them. However, if we were to put the teacher in that position, it would mean that they would have to go into the class while the teacher nurtures and supports the child at that given time when there's a crisis going on. I do think that we have got a lot of services around schools that are accessible. I think the difficulty is that each school has its own context, and what might be seen as a challenge at one school might not be a challenge at another school. So therefore, we have a we have a responsibility to make sure all children are included. And I know from my own experience, some of the things that the children at Broomhouse have done in the past would be something that would be catastrophic in a different school not that far away. But yet we manage it and are able to manage it because we know our children well and we know the services well. So in a way, there's an inequity of expectations in school of what children come with. And if we're going to be fully inclusive, which I absolutely agree with, and I agree with Paul Clancy, we do need to have more resources in school, because what we're tending to see is that a lot, you know, a small percentage of our children do take up a significant amount of teacher, management, pupil support assistant time. And if we're going to raise attainment for all, my concern is that amount of time being spent on that small percentage who really, really do require it, what's the effect having on the other 95% that don't require it but perhaps aren't getting as much of the service that they deserve to have as well, in order to make their attainment continue to improve? And that's the challenge. In terms of services, yes, we know about the mental health service and how the waiting lists are extensive. I don't know if there's a fast-tracking way of doing that, because children go through crisis at different times. There are many children that just suddenly go through a crisis and you have to react to that there and then. And to put in a referral for them because they've just had a serious trauma in their lives and to have to wait 9 months for it, or put in the referrals for other things, that can be too long for these children. And during that time, they're struggling to engage with mainstream education, where we want them to be. But we also then have the challenge, if we don't have them in mainstream education, where are they? Are they in a safe environment when they're not in mainstream education, if they're out of school? So yes, we do have a number of services. I do think that, you know, these services maybe aren't as extensive as they have been in the past, but I guess that's for us to creatively work out ways to use people to the best of their abilities and use those services to train and upskill the people working in schools to be able to deliver part of that service as well.
So I think that parents who don't engage often do so because of their own experience of the education system and social service system in this country. So there's a barrier there that needs to be broken down, because they may have a distrustful relationship with authority based on their own experiences. It's vital that that's broken down to allow them to see that teachers and authorities have the best intentions for their children and want to work with them to enable their children to achieve their potential. I mean, all parents really want to have discussions with the school about what's my child's potential, are they achieving it, and what can I do to support them achieving that. I think in the early days of Curriculum for Excellence, a new curriculum, unfamiliar to parents, and with teachers coming to grips with it, many teachers in schools would admit that that tracking was a work in progress and probably wasn't where it is today. I think the impact on parents then is that they weren't equipped with the correct information to understand where their child was and to fully support them. And for parents whose own literacy was perhaps more challenged, that was even more challenging to understand a whole new set of what to parents sometimes feels like jargon. So talking to parents in plain English about standardized assessment, what does that mean? What does it mean for the child? What's the plan for the child? And how can you help us is really important to parents.
Thank you, Vera. I think we're all agreed that closing the attainment gap is a good thing. However, over several years now, when we've been talking about attainment gaps, I've never actually been as clear as I should in terms of the targets that we should be using to measure that. How do we measure progress in this? Which targets should we be using?
Thanks, Mr. Beattie. Well, I think, firstly, at the senior phase end, we do have very clear data in terms of national qualifications and other awards. So we can see very clearly how individual young people, how schools, how local authorities are performing in relation to raising standards for all children and closing the gap. I think if we look further down the school, at primary school level, we haven't had a nationally consistent approach to this in order to look at the attainment gap and particularly poverty-related attainment gap. So that's why with the National Improvement Framework, there's a commitment to look at the children attaining Curriculum for Excellence levels. So if you think we've got a very clear framework of that children should achieve the early level in literacy and numeracy by the end of primary one, the first level by the end of primary four, the second level by the end of primary seven, and so on. So what
purely focus on academic achievement?
No, I think that one part of the story is the progress in literacy and numeracy using those levels. Some of the other measures, some of the things we see through profiles, because under Curriculum for Excellence, young people have a profile of their achievement, which looks at all the achievement they're attaining beyond literacy and numeracy, so how they've contributed to school life, for example, through community work and volunteering, for example, work that they've done in terms of being responsible citizens for the environment, for improving their locality. So at individual child level, there's very rich evidence and data of what they're achieving in the round. And what we're trying to do nationally is be clearer on progress in literacy and numeracy through the Curriculum for Excellence levels. But when the OECD were with us last year, they were really clear that one of the strengths that we saw was children's confidence, their engagement, their wider achievement. And through Curriculum for Excellence, there's a broader and richer experience than there has been before. And the challenge for us now is to make that consistently strong across Scotland.
But if we're talking about, for example, academic achievement you can measure by the number of certificates. A lot of what you're talking about is much more subjective. How do you get a consistent target or a consistent data coming back where a lot of it is subjective?
Well, I think you have to identify what data you want to look at. And as I say, with the National Improvement Framework, it is focusing on literacy and numeracy. But remember, the Curriculum for Excellence literacy and numeracy levels are very broad. It's not just about basic and reading and writing. It's looking at literacy across the curriculum, literacy beyond school, etc. So these levels are broad and they include quite a lot of skills and achievements. But I suppose the challenge is, how much of that data would you want to collect nationally and why? Because we don't want to cause perverse incentives here. We don't want to narrow the curriculum as well. So what we want to be assured of is, at individual child level, are they getting that broad, rich experience? Is that getting recognised? So some of the really simple ideas we've seen in the attainment challenge our schools in areas of poverty doing, thinking of things such as what are the 50 things they want every child to experience by the time they leave primary school? And that can be things like going to museums, etc. So things that other children would take for granted. So we have to be very clear, we've got the data for the senior phase, and that isn't just academic, that looks at vocational qualifications, it looks at wider awards as well. And what we're trying to do now is look at the progress through curriculum for excellence levels in primary school.
Are we satisfied that we've actually got consistent measures in place?
We do at the senior phase. We have the qualifications, we have the achievement awards, we have vocational qualification evidence. What we're working on is to look at developing that through the primary sector as well. And that was why the National Improvement Framework was introduced. So this year, for example, for the first time, there'll be the collection of those broad curriculum levels that I mentioned in literacy and numeracy. And that data can be looked at in terms of SIMD banding, so we can look at the difference in attainment of children from different socioeconomic backgrounds, so that we'll be able to see that particular, on that particular indicator, you know, how well children are progressing in literacy and numeracy. But it's really important that we look at this in the round, and we look at the context of each individual school and how it supports schools to tell their own story of how they're helping children to overcome the impact that poverty has on attainment and achievement.
Just to come in on that, I mean, you know, as a head teacher of a school, the question I ask the teachers throughout the year is, are these children making progress? If they are, how are they making progress, and what's your evidence of that? And to do that, you know, Education Scotland have given a lot of guidance and moderation and significant aspects of learning that we work with children. But within a primary school, a big part of the ethos is about achievement rather than attainment, although attainment is a significant part of that. And for us, if children can feel the sense of achievement, whether that be because they attend a judo club or they've won a medal in fencing or that they are part of a debating team, whatever it may be, they're made to feel that that is a valuable experience for them. And what we learn in schools is that more that children feel that they're achieving things, the more likely they are to engage in the other aspects which lead to the attainment, which will then lead to the national examinations later on. What we also do is we, you know, again, through the guidance of Education Scotland, we have a very clear system to prepare our children for skills for life and skills for work. And we do recognise that not all children necessarily will go to university. It's about finding what children's skills are and then finding the right places for those children to be able to develop those skills so that they can go off into a positive destination. We start that very early. We start that in nursery and primary school. And then we have good dialogue with the secondary schools to pass on that information so that hopefully when children go up to secondary school, they're not feeling that they are somewhere where they're out of their depth. And when they're out of their depth, their esteem goes right down and their learning suffers as a result of that. So, I mean, my question that I ask is, yes, we have got attainment measures that we have to follow. My attainment measure is, has a child from the start of the school session that you've had them in your class, have they made progress up until the end? And what kind of progress is that? So that we're not boxing children. I do worry that children that come into schools with far less literacy and far less numeracy, you know, if we test them too much, we're automatically putting them in a box for failure from day one. And that's not the right thing to have for a 4 or a 5-year-old. That doesn't help their self-esteem. It doesn't help their journey throughout school. And I think there needs to be an understanding that as professionals, the majority, if not all teachers, go into their school every single day with the best will in the world to help these children, to raise their attainment, to give them a positive destination. That is what they do. And I think, you know, we need to recognise that, and we need to have confidence and faith in our teachers. And I think it was Gillian Martin mentioned, you know, her husband being a guidance teacher and how the tabloid press does at times. Obviously, he's felt a hard time with that. I think in schools, you know, we're being told that we have to raise attainment all the time. I think there needs to be a recognition that every single school and every single teacher in Scotland has that very purpose. But perhaps the perception out in society is that maybe we don't have that purpose. And we do, we absolutely do. And that's, you know, that would be something that I think schools would very much welcome. I think parents would welcome. And it would give our teachers far more confidence because they are, to quote your phrase that you didn't like in the coalface, they're the ones delivering this every single day with passion, enthusiasm, and drive and commitment. So there are a number of things in place, and you know, we know where our children are. It's just, how do we benchmark that against other people? We can't, because we're told that schools are very individual places with a selection of different people who are very different, perhaps, to the people in a school that could be 300 yards away. But with the best will in the world, that school is doing the best that it can for the children there. I think the point that John Swinney made in his paper about cluster working is vitally important. So in our context, we have four schools in my cluster. They are very different schools, but we purposefully learn from each other. We have our teachers working with each other, moderating with each other, so that we are coming to common standards of what the curriculum should be and able to then go back to our schools and say, yes, we are on the right track with that, or actually, no, we're not. This is something we need to develop further over the coming years. So we are, you know, I think in terms of attainment, I think the teachers knowing the children inside out is the best form of deciding where a child is in their journey through education, and then the passing on that information through the profiles that Graham mentioned.
Before I let you in, could I, Tavish, you've got a supplementary?
Yeah, the same theme of questioning that Colin Beattie's been asking about. Mr. Petrie, I get what you've just said, but I get as particularly as a parent, if I may say, as of a primary school child, but what I can't get is how that's consistent with national government's desire to have tests, and they have been calling them tests, at primary level right through primary school level, and then be able to do comparisons, because again, that's what Mr. Swinney's been saying in Parliament a number of times. That's not consistent at all with the point you've very fairly just made about we can't benchmark one primary school against another.
No, but what these tests, which, you know, again, I've not been party to what those tests are, so I can't comment on them, but I'm assuming what these tests will be, you know, a lot of the standardised testing that is currently used in schools was created before Curriculum for Excellence came out. So therefore, what we're asking children to do in terms of standardised testing isn't necessarily fully reflective of the curriculum that we're delivering. So on the assumption that these national tests that are coming out will actually be entirely based on the Curriculum for Excellence experiences and outcomes, then the assumption is that as all teachers, we are tasked to deliver the experiences and outcomes in our own creative way, but we are tasked to track whether these children have achieved them, whether it be at the end of first level, early level, second level. So therefore, these standardised tests that are going to come out will hopefully be more of a reflection of what the Curriculum for Excellence is in real terms, rather than what perhaps standardised testing was previously.
Which is that standardised tests have to include teacher judgment, and that teacher judgment is individual to that class.
Yeah.
And again, how then can we, as looking at this from a parliamentary level, see a comparison from one school to the next?
Yeah.
Because teacher judgment doesn't allow that to happen, does it?
Well, teacher judgment is based on what the teachers are delivering to the children, which is consistent throughout the country. You know, the experiences and outcomes are the same in Inverness as they are in Edinburgh, as they are in Glasgow.
I think I could pick an argument on that one, but anyway, go on. Yeah.
And again, it's trusting teachers that they are following them. And I guess that's back to Paul Clancy's point about the leadership in schools. That's the robust systems that each individual school has to ensure the quality of the education that's happening, in line with the Her Majesty's Inspectorate that come in to either verify or to offer support to schools when they come into schools to assess and check what position the school is in delivering the curriculum.
So do you think after the national framework's been in place for a couple of years, we will see statistics, well, you'll tell me, but at what point will we see statistics which allow us to compare school performance against school performance? Because that's what we keep being told we're going to be able to see.
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, that's a debate that, as a head teacher of a school, I'm not hugely qualified to put my.
I think you're very qualified, if I may say.
Well,
so.
Well, to put my opinion,
if you're,
you know, I suppose if you're asking me, do I want my school to be compared to another school?
Yeah.
I do purposely, just because of the way that I am. I am interested in what my local school's attainment results are, because we have that conversation as a cluster, and then if one particular school has a real strength in a particular area, then we wouldn't be using our professional skills particularly well if we didn't then go in and say, right, well, what is it you've been doing that allows that to happen? And as head teachers in schools, we have the autonomy to be able to do that. And then we can take the best ideas from other schools. If it's going to be used as a tool for parents to decide where to send their children, that's a whole different matter. Because again, you know, going back to what Lindsay had said, as a head teacher, it's very much my job to absolutely manage and support our parents to know exactly what the curriculum is, to know exactly what inclusion is, to know exactly what GRFEC is. That's our role in school, along with our, you know, partner agencies at Education Scotland, who put out a huge amount of work the parent zone who put a huge amount, it does go back again to the inequality of people being able to access that due to their literacy. So again, from our context, we need to get parents into school more and talk to them in terms of the language that I can't remember which Member of Parliament asked Mr. Swinney to ensure that parents got it in a language that was for parents. That, I suppose, comes back to us. That's our role to do that, because if we don't do that and share that correctly with our parents, then of course they're never going to understand. And that again comes back to the leadership of schools. And most schools that I work with have parents in an awful lot more than certainly when I was at school. My parents were never in school other than a parents' evening. Now you'll find it's a very commonplace in most schools to have parents in quite regularly, which is good because it builds their understanding of what the curriculum and inclusion is and where their child is.
Thank you.
Just maybe to go back to Mr. Beattie's original question, which was to do with the measures that you might use in terms of determining whether you've closed the attainment gap. And I think you will need some long-term measures, you'll need some medium-term, and you'll need some things that are happening on a term-by-term basis. And I think the senior phase results would be our traditional examination results, along with the positive destination measures. They are important measures to show that in a long-term way you've made a change and that the attainment gap has been closed. So we will be looking to these, but these are obviously long-term measures, but they remain important. For me, I think another important set of measures would be what happens when a child actually starts their education, because we know if they're not school-ready, it's very, very difficult to get them to catch up to other young people who are. So I think we know what they need to be. We know in terms of where their language development needs to be. We know in terms of where their coordination needs to be, their experiences that they need to have had. We know what that is. The issue is actually not just measuring it. It's actually ensuring that it happens. That's the trick, because we've got so many of our young people coming through who've not had these experiences, and it just takes so long. It's an uphill battle to try and bring them to where other young people are. So I think there needs to be, whether it's fully defined, I mean, health visitors have very clear measures that they use for children as they reach certain parts in their life journey. There maybe needs to be something round about that starting point that we can say, we feel this child's ready. So there's something I think that's it's not maybe missing there, but it needs to be fully defined. I think Graham's right in terms of literacy and numeracy. That needs to be measured in an ongoing way. And for me, that's the actual core that determines a young person's progress throughout their primary career. And I think parents have an absolute right to know in a standardised way based on national operation where the child is in literacy and numeracy. I don't think it's too much to ask that we can say this is where they are in their numeracy journey. And that's what this means. And this is what it means across Scotland. If we say this is what it means, and we should be able to establish it in very, very clear language. And I think we've gone a long way in trying to define what that is. But I would accept there's a journey to go, because you've got, you know, thousands of teachers that are going to be using a mixture of standardised assessments in their own judgment. There's a bit of work there to get a common language. We've been through this before with 5 to 14. There is some journey that needs to happen to get us to that point. But I think there's an absolute entitlement for parents to be able to be told this is where they are in the numeracy journey. And it's by mapping that literacy, numeracy, and I think Graham mentioned it too, this achievement journey that actually happens as they go through school, that helps us keep an eye on the attainment gap itself. Where that's tight and it's close together and there's not too many big gaps, you'll find by the time they're getting into the senior phase, they're ready for the examinations. So it's not too many measures. It's getting the right measures at the right times. So I think for me, at the start of the school journey, literacy and numeracy throughout the school journey, with the examination results, with the positive destinations at the end as the long-term measure, These are the key things, with an absolute guarantee that we're talking with a consistent language, and that requires some work.
William, you've got a short supplementary.
Very short supplementary, just based on what Jamie was saying there about measurement, and how is it incumbent on us as parliamentarians maybe not to be so obsessive about the stats and actually to look at the whole picture of what achievement and attainment actually is? And is there anything that we can do to help reflect what's happening in schools in a way that isn't just boiled down to numbers that we beat each other over the head about in the chamber?
And that would be lovely. I mean, I do have to say, in praise of the inspection process, the inspection process does look at achievements in school. It looks at the school ethos. It looks at everything that a school is. It doesn't focus itself on the attainment. Of course, they look at the attainment because we are accountable for our children. We have to make sure they're making progress. But I think, you know, what the majority, and hopefully Graham will agree with me, is the majority of times when a child is not achieving what they should be doing, the parent will know about that. An intervention programme will be put in place with the parent as a partner, and other agencies that are required will also be in that process through the child's planning system. You know, there's two ways of looking at it. I suppose somewhere along the line, somebody needs to be able to say that education is getting better in Scotland. For me, I think when I look at I've been doing this job for 20 years, when I look at the teachers that are coming into education now, the skills and knowledge and expertise they're bringing in compared to when I started as a teacher 20 years ago is far higher. The use of research, the use of creativity, the use of risk-taking, the opportunity for teachers to actually take the experiences and outcomes and deliver them the way that they want with their children. And that's a key part of this, is it's not about the teacher in the school saying this is what we're going to learn. It's about the children being involved in that process, which is helping with their emotional literacy and everything else that builds a bigger picture. All of that is significantly better than I can ever remember it being. Which is a real positive for me. As Graham says, you walk into any school and talk to a child now, they will talk back to you with confidence. That's without even knowing what picture lies behind that child. You know, the trauma they've gone through, the bereavements they've seen, the awful things they've seen in their life. For some reason in schools, because we have that caring ethos as well as high aspirations, which, you know, I think is a hugely important thing for us, is that the bigger picture is that we are doing everything we can. Teachers are working incredibly hard to make the best for their children. And I suppose, in my perspective, you know, maybe our attainment isn't as high as somebody would like it to be, or it isn't at the national level, it's not far off it, which, you know, is really quite good for Broomhouse, is that actually we don't need to be slated for it, because we are working absolutely to our maximum to give the best to these children. And I suppose it's just for our government to have confidence that that's what we're doing. And the inspection process does do that, you know, with us, and it does support as if it's not quite right, which is good.
I would urge extreme caution in comparing school against school and setting communities against each other, and encouraging parents to look at that data and then decide to make an upheaval in their life to move school. It doesn't. In the Cabinet Secretary's speech, he talks about identifying successful schools, but the reality is that schools in deprived areas are doing other things. They're working very hard. Primary school teachers are finding clothes for children, or finding food for children when they come in the morning. That's time that's taken away from attainment in literacy and numeracy. So we should be very cautious about using literacy and numeracy attainment to define success of schools. Yes. I have now no doubt that the majority of parents and the vast majority of parents and teachers across the country have one thing in mind, and that's successful and happy children. And it is wrong to assume that a school that has low attainment isn't a successful, well-led and happy school.
Okay. Very briefly, please.
Just going to agree with what Jamie was saying. You know, the inspection model, which has been redesigned, looks at achievement and attainment, and it evaluates the breadth of experience that young people are offered, the quality of their achievement, and that is equally valued along with some of the other attainment measures. And to go back to Ms. Martin's point about, you know, not just picking out sets of data, you know, we would agree that we've got to judge the system on a balanced range of different measures and indicators, and picking out one criteria or one measure does cause perverse incentives, and it can be damaging. So we're currently working with parent organisations and others to develop parent zone, which will have a page in each school, which will tell the story of that school using a whole range of evidence and information, so that you'll get a real flavour of that school in the round, what it's offering, how well it's doing. And I think as a country, that is what we want to move forward with, not just picking out individual measures, but telling the whole story of the school and looking at success in the round.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to Ross Greer, but before I do, can I just ask that both the questions and the answers are shorter. We've got an awful lot to get through within the next hour or so, so let's try and keep it succinct and answer the questions. Thank you, Ross.
Going back to some of the answers that came out of Daniel Johnson's questions, I think Jamie quite rightly observed that a small number of pupils take up quite a large amount of resource and time, which is right. Resource deployment is obviously going to have a huge bearing on how we close the attainment gap, but to use another coalface-like buzzword, there's a bit of a postcode lottery going on when it comes to identifying young people with those additional support needs in the first place. So in Renfrewshire, 15% of young people have been identified as having additional support needs. It's 35% in neighbouring West and Bartonshire. I don't think there's actually a 20-point gap in between those two groups of young people. From your experience, is there a consistency, and is it happening early enough in actually identifying young people with additional support needs, or are there issues there that are going to prevent us from deploying resources correctly?
I think children's needs are identified from a very young age, from the health visitor at birth. And then when they move into nursery years, the nursery staff are very skilled at identifying if children have needs. And at all stages, those needs are discussed and strategies are put into place for those children. And that then continues throughout the school. So there is a consistency within a school of working out where the needs are. In terms of nationally, I don't have the answer to that. I don't know if Graham may more or yourself might.
So I would say from parents' perspective, parents are the foremost expert in their own child. And quite often we hear from parents who say their voices aren't listened to when they've asked for a diagnosis and they struggle to engage with that support. So I think parents' voices should become louder in that discussion. The experts should listen to parents when they say they feel there's a problem with their child. And I think some parents are telling us that that's actually not happening universally across Scotland at the moment.
Just to go back to Mr. Greer's question, I think, as Jamie and Paul have said, there is earlier identification. Paul mentioned the 23-month health visitor assessment, for example. What that shows is about developmental issues, early literacy, and what we're working on the attainment challenge is that information being shared with nurseries and early learning providers and schools so that health and education are working together to intervene as early as possible. You're right in that there's different ways that additional support for learning is classified in different local authorities, and I think that's something that colleagues in other parts of the government are looking at, that consistency, if that is the gateway to other support. But I would also agree with Lindsay in that the progress we're seeing through getting it right for every child and the best practice, parents are fully involved in that planning process. Their concerns are listened to, professionals working together around the family and around the child. And the challenge is making that consistently strong across the country.
Paul, do you have anything
to add to that? Just to agree, I think my experience certainly is that we do identify the young people. I think parents play an absolutely critical role there and we need to work better. But for some reason, it's not always recorded. And I think it's just maybe to do with the way that systems are interpreted. So the young person may be receiving additional support, but it might not be classified as an additional support needs. There is quite a lot of variance across Scotland in how it's captured, but that's not to say that they're not getting the support. So there probably is, I think, a need to look at that and try and regularise that across the country.
Spirit of short questions, do you think that making support for learning posts a promoted post would be a welcome development in this area, or would that not perhaps be necessary?
I think in some respects, we require support for learning expertise. It comes from teachers, it'll come from educational psychologists, it'll come from allied health professionals. But more and more, we're actually looking upon classroom teachers as being able to work with pupils with a whole range of needs. And a lot of the expertise that's required is actually at ground level. So, I can't make a call there in terms of payment, but I would say the way that we currently do this is we say the classroom teacher is every bit as important as anyone else because they've got to work with the young people with the needs. And more that's happening at the coal faces we've been speaking about today.
I think on that point, I think there needs to be a recognition of how much time GRFEC takes within a school's outage in a day. I'm by no means one of the most deprived schools in Scotland. I have 43 children who are on the GRFEC cycle. And to put that in a context, you know, to go back to what John Swinney was saying about unnecessary bureaucracy and teacher workload, any child that's on the child planning system, which is where we have the parental involvement, we have the other agencies, we have a whole team working around that child. You know, that takes the class teacher to write a report about the child. It takes the class teacher to attend the child's planning meeting. It takes the class teacher to take the strategies out of that meeting and implement them into their classroom. And what we've also got to recognise is that these are the same class teachers that have to plan for curriculum for excellence at the same time. So if you were to ask me if there was a wish list, I think there needs to be more resources put into schools to support the implementation of effective GRFEC. We do it effectively within the structures that we have within our school, but what we have to recognise is that when we're doing that, that's taking away our capability of putting in more resources into delivering the curriculum for excellence and all aspects of that. And that's something we do have to take seriously. We're asking teachers, you know, that in one of my classes, just to give you an example, we have seven children, all who have individualized programs for their daily life in a classroom. So each of those seven children require the teacher to have something in place for those seven children, but there's also another 23 children who don't have anything that still deserve to have exactly the same amount of the teacher's time put into making creative, progressive, exciting, challenging lessons. And that's where the whole workload issue can become an issue for teachers.
Liz, followed by Joanne.
Thank you, Convener. Could I ask, do you believe that the measure of free school meals is the best one in terms of identifying children who require help?
Yeah, sorry. I think, you know, this is a real challenge for allocating potentially additional resources, because under the Scottish Attainment Challenge, we're working at Education Scotland with local authorities and the Scottish Government to allocate funding for targeted areas where there's high levels of children living in poverty. What we've been using to date is SIMD data and looking at SIMD bands 1 and 2. Now, that's not a perfect measure. No measure really is perfect, I think, because it's really difficult to develop really simple, clear criteria that will identify poverty in all parts of the country. For example, in Scotland, we've got a lot of rural poverty, which postcodes wouldn't help to identify. Free school meal entitlement wouldn't necessarily capture either. So I think we need to continue to look at what measures we can use to identify children, particularly with the Scottish Government delivery plan talking about moving to pupil equity funding across a lot of parts of Scotland. We have to try and develop criteria that are simple and clear, that public and parents and others can understand, that capture poverty as effectively as possible. But it's really, really difficult thing to do, and we're actually looking at other countries. We've got our colleagues in ADES, Association of Directors of Education, have got quite strong views on this as well. So I think it's really challenging to find a set of criteria that are clear and fair that will accurately identify poverty.
For providing a satisfactory criteria, given that there's a lot of public money about to be invested in the attainment fund?
I think for that, the move to the pupil equity funding element of the attainment challenge is scheduled from April next year, and what we're working on is a framework to be published in December, and our contribution to that framework will be the educational strategies and so on to give schools guidance, and understand that that will also set out the criteria for the actual allocation of the funding.
Could I just ask, what is your understanding of the announcement that's been made that the money that would be provided for the attainment fund, which is raised through council tax, is it your understanding that the allocation of that would be done by central government?
The current aspects of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, the Challenge Authorities and Schools Programme, the money is allocated from the Scottish Government to local authorities, and the Schools Programme also goes through local authorities, and they submit plans which we scrutinise educationally. We've got sort of set of criteria that we use to judge the educational merits of those local plans. We work with our academic partner at Glasgow University and others to do that as well. In terms of the actual mechanism for the money going from the government, I don't know the sort of final position on how that money will actually be physically transferred. I'm not sure if that's what you're asking. Is it?
Would you accept, though, that's a very important decision that's got to be made? Because if you come up with an acceptable criteria by which you make the judgment of which children need help, Not only do these criteria have to be very clear to everybody in education, but there has to be a clear model of funding that will allow that allocation to take place. And yesterday we heard that there could be regional, some kind of regional structure, as well as local authorities, and obviously as well as the central government, that there are issues about how that money would be allocated. I'd be interested to know, in terms of a head teacher, how would you like that decision-making process to take place?
I think that's something well above my pay grade to make that decision. You know, the headline was that schools will get £100 million. The reality is that, yes, I think like any head teacher, if you gave me money directly, I will use it effectively. But there has to be a system in place to know that that's going to happen consistently throughout the country. Otherwise, we're in a risk that money could go into schools and not be used effectively. So you know, we do have to have justification as how we want to spend that money. And I guess the criteria that we're given currently from Education Scotland makes it very clear what the expectations that funding should be used for, and that funding does need a level of somebody being able to look over it and go, yes, that's an acceptable way. I can see why you're doing that. That's not devaluing my judgment as a head teacher. That, for me, is just another quality assurance process that keeps my confidence that we are going along the right lines.
You and Mr. Logan, when he says that the SIMD has not been particularly satisfactory as a model, and that obviously some research going on just now to make the criteria a bit fair.
Yeah. Sir Logan, did you not say it wasn't perfect?
Yeah, I mean,
which is a slightly different response.
Yeah, there is no perfect measure around the world really for capturing this accurately. So SIMD has worked in terms of looking at the data we've got, and it draws on a range of data, but we are really keen to get the best possible approach to this to identify both our urban and rural poverty.
Just to be absolutely clear, am I right that the research that's currently being undertaken involving some international studies is looking at models other than SIMD?
We are keen to look at how this is done in different parts of the world. The Scottish government position at the moment is obviously SIMD, and there's been talk about free school meal entitlement as being the criteria. There's a lot of varying views on that, and I think, you know, a decision will need to be taken. What I am saying is I don't think there's a perfect model for this anywhere, because how do you genuinely identify poverty in individual households? And it's a real, real challenge to do that in a consistent way. And also, in terms of your point about the actual allocation of the fundings, I think what we have to be absolutely assured on is that leads to additionality. So when the money is used in schools and local authorities, that this is actually providing additional interventions and additional support for children. And again, I think that will be a challenge for us to ensure that this money is actually leading to additionality for children and their families.
So we find out in December.
We've got a very brief supplementary.
Yeah, a brief supplementary just on Liz's line of questioning. It's even in the Spice briefing paper where Education Scotland say that the new funding will reach around 95% of schools in Scotland. So it's to ask if you could give me clarity on who are the 5% that won't be receiving it, and where are they?
I think the policy decision around the criteria is still something that's underway. I mean, some of those illustrations where if you use free school meal entitlement, you can model what that would mean if you use SIMD. So there's different models around showing ways in which the percentage of schools that would reach. So, you know, if you look at SIMD, what we're actually talking about with that funding is an amount of cash per child, you know, following the child. So, you know, if you use free school meal entitlement, you can work out exactly how many schools that would involve and how many children. If you use SIMD 1 and 2, you can work that out. So there's different examples out there, and I think when the framework is published by the Scottish Government in December, as it will outline the educational strategies, which is the focus of the team I'm working with, to look at all the different evidence on what actually works to improve literacy and numeracy and health and wellbeing for children living in poverty. And it will also, I understand, outline some of the wider issues about policy decisions around the allocation of the funds, the accountability and so on.
Thanks very much. I'm interested in the whole question, first of all, around assessment. It seems to me that what you do is simply describe the attainment gap. by testing. You're identifying, I think Mr. Clancy said, the right of the parent to know, so they know where their child is, but that only describes it. The action you take to close the attainment gap must be something very different from that. And I wonder whether you have a view on, you know, I get that individual schools with the same kinds of profiles, so one school will attain more than another. So at one level, the assessment of that maybe identifies where there's weakness in practice in one school against the other. But in terms of the bigger picture, do you think that the focus on individual schools will help close the gap, or will just simply confirm the gap exists? What needs to be done maybe at local authority level?
I think the for me, local authorities' role is to really to ensure that the quality, to ensure that the targets are right, that the schools are being properly supported, and that there's leadership within these schools to be able to take the schools forward. And I think in terms of whether it's within a local authority or an extended educational regional approach, it's the same principle. It's to share good practice and to bring schools together. So evidence-based research, evidence-based work that's shown to be successful can be replicated. And that's really the role of the authority, is to provide the leadership and to ensure that there's leadership in schools. That's key. And it's to bring the schools together to share the practice and to ensure that that's disseminated and shared. And I think it does have to happen on an individual school basis. In fact, I would argue it needs to happen on an individual pupil basis, looking at what the pupil's needs are and where that pupil's realised potential should be. I think comparisons are helpful to a certain extent, but the real work happens with the individual young person, in ensuring that they reach what their potential is.
Surely if the focus is on the individual rather than the school, the emphasis of the current Scottish Government's approach, which is about the school and about leadership, is probably missing quite an important element of all of this. I mean, would you not accept, or do you have a view on, that if children bring to school with them a range of issues and challenges, that it won't simply be the school that's going to be able to address that? So putting a child's needs in the context of all of the services that the local authority provides, whether it's housing, whether it's social work or whatever, makes sense?
Well, absolutely. But schools, for me, play a fundamental part in the operation of the authority. I know that some people see that there's a difference between what's called the local authority centre and the schools, but schools are part of the local authority. And we've really moved a long way towards schools being seen as community assets, working within a community with community resources. And I think that's one of the things that GIRFEC has really brought about. It's placed schools quite centrally into that range of support that's there. And if anything happens in terms of whatever the changes might be through the governance review, we've got to ensure that schools remain full partners in the GIRFEC community-centred approach along with the other services. They can't retreat back to just being educators, just being the deliverers of literacy and numeracy. They must remain in that high ground, because it's in that role, in the coordinating position that they have through named person, lead professional, and I know that's been debated, but what's set out in the legislation, they play quite a central role in assuring that these resources are brought to bear, because they're with the young people 5 days a week from 9 to 3:30. They're operating with the parents. They're pivotal parts of a community asset. So wherever we go with the governance, I think schools need to remain firmly embedded within the GIRFEC operation across services.
The logic of that position is that you would, that regional educational boards doesn't really address that. We've got something already there that fits that. Can I ask Mr. Logan this question about directing resources? You said the schools need to prove additionality. But what you said earlier was that in some of our schools, young people arrive at school where there's already a gap. So is it not the mainstream core function of education to address that gap? And if that is a core mainstream function, why do the resources have to prove additionality? Is that not the core business, and the funding should be directed to these schools in order to allow the schools to address that problem?
Yeah, I think that is absolutely the core business of schools, as Jamie and others have said, and every teacher I meet is entirely committed to doing that. And of course, all the core funding that goes into schools is identified for that. What I was referring to was the additional money on top of all the core funding that comes through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. and that is to enable us to try out new and innovative ideas to make the breakthrough we need, because all the commitment, all of what we're doing is helping, but this additional money needs to offer something extra in terms of extra support for children.
With respect, what it's showing is that the core funding is inadequate in these schools.
It's trying out innovative new ideas. It's providing space for us to try different things. So it's there to complement and enhance and to enable us to do extra work with children.
But surely you must accept that the core job in some of our schools is more difficult to deliver if a child is coming 15 months behind a child in of its peers from a different set of circumstances. So the funding shouldn't be challenge funding, shouldn't be additional funding. The innovative stuff, that works in any walk of life, it's extra money. But this is there not a strong argument at the level of delivering on education budgets, you should factor in at that stage that the core funding for these schools needs to be higher because the gap is so significant when they arrive in school itself?
I think, you know, that there's a range of things that can be done by school. I mean, every school is dealing with children coming in with different needs. And the focus that we've been looking at educationally on this argument is around how learning can be enhanced, how learning can be organised to help children. So the example I gave earlier in relation to your question about the 15-month gap is that some of the schools we're working with are changing the curriculum in primary one to offer a much more literacy-rich and play-based experience to reduce that gap. So our focus educationally on this is looking at the ideas and the strategies that make the difference in literacy and numeracy. I think the whole funding models are a different issue, probably not one for me to comment on. As I say, our focus is looking at educational interventions and educational additionality through the networks we've created in the Attainment Challenge, of bringing teachers and head teachers together to look at what works, to work with Glasgow University as our senior academic advisor, and to share the practice through the team that we've established of attainment advisors who are working out on the ground with teachers and head teachers to look at what's working and to share that practice. So a big additional amount of support and focus on what actually works and what strategies are making the most difference to children living in poverty. And that's the focus of the work that I'm involved in at Education Scotland.
I think every school deals with the same set of problems. Every child has its own challenges, that's but right. The attainment gap tells us there's a distinct problem in some of our schools because of the challenges that children bring with them into school. But can I ask Mr. Petrin, this is really my last point. I think that there's been a number of issues and strategies you've talked about, but in your written submission, you talk about the impact of significant cuts to the service around schools had. And I wonder if you wanted to develop that point, because, I mean, certainly, you know, we can talk about testing, we can talk about in-school initiatives, but to what extent are you able to draw on resources beyond the school for children who have got other needs that are barriers to them even sitting to be able to learn?
Yep, I mean, I suppose from my perspective, you know, GIRFEC, which is a very inclusive model, which has absolutely got to be what we are in mainstream education. Every child should have the opportunity to be in mainstream education. I think over the past number of years, you know, the allocation of special school places for children have become less and less. And actually the criteria to be able to get your child into special school, because ultimately it's a difficult decision for a parent to make, it's a difficult decision for a school to make, it has to be correct. But ultimately when teachers go through their initial teacher education, you know, I would question what skills teachers come into schools have to work with very challenging children for whom a number of our teachers have never been trained in the same way that teachers that worked in special schools were trained to work with these children in a smaller environment. You know, we have more and more children with very, very complex needs. The complex needs are now being identified in different, I think in different authorities, different ways, I'm not entirely sure. And you either get an audit allocation for those children, at which point you can bring in a member of staff to work with that child, or you don't get anything. And for me, it's about that whole picture of GIRFEC, the teacher having to deal with this, 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 and this, as well as their core business of delivering curriculum for excellence. Now, we know if these children are in the right place, of course they'll learn, but that doesn't take away that sometimes that can be quite challenging in a classroom setting. It can be quite challenging for other children in that classroom setting with these children or that child that's maybe going through a trauma at that time. So in terms of the resources around the school, I absolutely commend the Scottish Government for protecting teacher numbers. However, teachers are just a small part. You know, if you take my school, we're a nine class school, and I have 27 members of staff. So, you know, there are nine classes, but there are 27 members of staff. So it's not just about the teacher. It's about all the other services around schools that when we are struggling, because we're not psychologists, we're not social workers, you know, we're teachers, that's our core business, is that if we really identify children that have needs, it's being able to get that seen to by professionals, that perhaps there's slightly less of that than there maybe was in previous times. And you know, that was my point with that, is that the expectation now is that schools can fix lots of things. And schools do a fantastic job. They just can't necessarily do everything around a picture of a child. And that's from birth onwards. I mean, we now have two-year-old nurseries in Edinburgh, you know, so we're bringing in the children at that point where we know by the time a child reaches the age of three, a lot of their behaviours and mannerisms are set, and that we can make a difference over time in school. However, a child that comes in aged four or five that's had a proper literate upbringing, they're in a far better position. But we don't see those children until they're that age. But now we're beginning to see them as two-year-olds for the most vulnerable families, which, you know, I think is a good thing. It's just, there seems to be a lot of services where, you know, they just don't have the capacity to support schools when perhaps they used to.
Thank you. Would you like to come in on
this? So we, at SPTC, we agree that resources need to be provided to teachers and to schools to improve outcomes for children who are raised in poverty. And we would favour an across-school approach targeting potentially free school meals. It's not a perfect indicator, but not every child who's raised in poverty lives in an area that pops up in the SIMD indicator. But unless we look at the causal links between poverty and attainment, then we are not going to break the link. And essentially we're asking teachers and schools to apply a great big sticking plaster over a gaping wound of inequality in our society. They're bringing children up to where they should be, they're helping them improve their attainment, but they're not being able to tell parents why the child isn't achieving from the moment they step into schools. And unless we can answer that question, we can't tell parents what they need to do, and we can't tell the support agencies that work with families from birth and before birth how they should support their child get ready for education. And until we do that, we can't create a sustainable model that will allow the next generation of children who will be born into poorer families to, from birth, begin to achieve.
Thank you very much, Richard. Do you want to come in here?
Yeah, I think. Firstly, good morning and thanks for your evidence today. It's been amazing. I think Lindsay's last point and Jamie's previous points are quite linked, because just to step back from the whole debate over attainment, and there are some solutions that will be in school and there'll be lots of solutions that are out with the school. So I guess my question is, are you confident we're going to get the balance right? I know the debate's kind of still to take place, but is there not a danger, as I perhaps see at the moment, that the whole debate over attainment is going to be about politicians in the parliamentary chamber arguing about the amount of money that's going towards education, as opposed to getting to the root of some of the issues that impact on attainment? Because one of the biggest issues I hear about from teachers is what Jamie Petrie mentioned over GIRFEC, and the increasing demands in the classroom, but of course that needs more resources. And likewise, preventative spend is all about trying to help children and families before classrooms have to deal with some of the fallout we cause in society.
Yeah, I'm happy to answer something initially. I think we're a year into the Scottish Attainment Challenge, and provide some level of reassurance about getting the balance right. We've had local authorities such as Dundee and the other eight challenge authorities and the schools we're working directly with preparing local plans for how they can bring the improvements and the support for children and their families. And there is a heartening amount of involvement of professionals and partners other than teachers, so third sector organisations. Jamie mentioned Barnardo's. We've got many others at local level working together to provide additional services and support for children and their families. In Dundee, we've got family support workers in schools there, helping families to access services as a result of the attainment challenge. And a big focus in moving into year two is around families and communities. So we've just appointed a coordinator for family learning, for example, and our idea there is that we'll work together with partners in a locality to build a family learning offer. So if you're living in an area of multiple deprivation, it will be really clear what support's available for you as a family, how to navigate that, and all those services will come together. So families and communities is equally as important as the learning and teaching and leadership elements of the attainment challenge moving forward, and we'll continue to make sure there is the right balance in the local plans with the involvement of partners who work with teachers and other educationalists.
I think it's just, you know, education's been around for a long time. Governments come and go. I think whatever happens, teachers will be fully committed to doing the best for their children in every school in Scotland. And I think, you know, have confidence in us and have faith in us. We're doing the best we can. And I think we have a very good education system in Scotland. And figures are figures. But, you know, come into school, see what's going on. It's an amazing place to go into. And kids are thriving. And our poorest kids are getting a lot of support, and we will continue, no matter what the resources are, to give them the best support that we can.
I think just to back up what Jamie's saying, and you probably all have familiarity with schools, and I know in terms of your work, you'll be in and out of them, and you'll see the differences. But when I look back on what schools were like when I was there, or even I suppose when my oldest children were at school, they're fundamentally different in terms of the number of people who are passing in and out of these schools, other professionals. When I was there, you maybe got the occasional, you know, a drama person came in to do something. Our schools, if you just check the visitors' sign in and out book, you'll see the number of paraprofessionals and other agencies that are in and out of our schools. And as we actually examine the programmes for schools, particularly individual child's plans, you'll see the range of practitioners that are actually working. And that's from parent helpers, who play an extremely important part, right up to Developing Scotland's young workforce, where we've got strong partnerships emerging with employers who are playing a really pivotal part in, I think, changing the culture of how teachers consider what learning and teaching is about. It's not just about the delivery of knowledge, it's about preparing young people for the workplace. So when I see the diversity of partners that we're actually operating with, I would say that the balance is definitely, whether it's absolutely correct, you need to measure that over time, keep testing the waters. But certainly we've got a wide range of partners across the key elements, and I think that's heartening to see. And the other thing I would say is young people respond to it very well. They respond well to their teachers, but they respond well to the delivery, I suppose, of the educational process coming in a variety of ways. The other thing is that there's young people spending more time out with schools, particularly in the senior phase. They're spending time in other schools, they're spending time in colleges, they're spending time with employers. So I think that whole notion of things just happening in the building between teachers and pupils has really broken down in the last 20 years, and we have a far better position for experiences for the youngsters in our schools.
Also the parents that are now engaging with us that had negative experiences of schools have now got a very positive experience of school. That positive experience of school will rub off on their children, so that hopefully in the next generation of our children having children, they'll have a positive experience of school. And I think that's one of the big barriers that we're breaking down significantly.
Thank you. Fulton, and then we'll finish with Julian.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Convener. I suppose I'm just wondering what the panel think about the new autonomy that schools and particularly head teachers will get. I know we've touched a wee bit on it, but do the panel think that this will be an opportunity for communities to come together around the school, for parents to be more involved in that process, and to deliver outcomes that are individualised for the kids that go to the school?
I'm happy to see, I think, in terms of schools working with their parents and communities, in the best schools today, that happens. that happens, where the leadership is there, where that's part of the vision of the school, that's already happening. We've got communities coming, gathering around the school, working with parents. In terms of providing further opportunities, whether you require that to be done through changes in legislation or law or governance reviews, I think what happens is it's cultural changes, it's ensuring the leadership's there to take that forward. There's nothing that I've read in any kind of educational research or any kind of papers or initiatives that doesn't indicate that school leadership working within a community produces the best results and change for young people. And that's a message that's been going out at educational leadership conferences from Education Scotland, from a variety of other researchers for many, many years. So we know what needs to happen. We just need to ensure that, I think, staff and schools have the confidence to be able to do this. CFE was a big cultural change because it did say to schools, have they take the initiative, have the ability to really think things through and define the curriculum in terms of your own context. So there's going to be a critical core of numeracy and literacy. There's outcomes and experiences that hold it together, but you're going to determine how this happens with your teachers, with your pupils, and with your parents. And in the best expressions of curriculum for excellence, that is what HMI have found has happened. So whether we actually need to go to the stage of wherever the governance review is going to go, and I can't comment on it, to get to that point, I think the destination has already been agreed. Nobody's disagreeing with what the destination is. It's just what you need to put in place to take you towards that. That, I think, is where the argument might be.
And following on from that, then, do you think that the proposal and the policy to give more schools more autonomy is an indication of the government's view that that schools are delivering well and that they are, in many cases, best placed to meet the needs of individual children? If I can just give you a wee example, one of the areas in the top 10 most deprived in the recent stats that were released is in my own constituency, and actually the high school in that particular area is doing a very innovative programme in terms of a literacy skills festival, and which I'll be attending in the next couple of weeks. But it's stuff like that. For me, there's pockets of it, you know, everywhere, and there's different examples. But I think that the government, you know, are promoting that for schools to do over the country as a whole.
I'm not disagreeing with that, and I'm certainly not trying to question whatever where the governance review will go. And I'm conscious that I work within a local authority, and that's obviously part of what the discussion is where local authorities sit. I suppose the point I'm trying to make is whether or not you legislate for something that doesn't make it happen, it happens because school leaders make it happen. So what you're actually trying to say is how do you get the best leadership within our schools to allow it to happen? I'm saying that local authorities, everyone has to ensure that culture is there to allow it to happen and that the leadership is there and it's supported and schools are supported to do it. There's nothing that would prevent any school today being innovative in the way that you've actually described. It doesn't require legislation or changes to allow that to happen. It can happen. Whether that's required, that's a matter for government and it's a matter for discussion. I couldn't comment on that.
We talked quite a lot today about parental engagement and about how some parents feel that coming into like primary schools is very difficult for them. And it's very interesting to hear what Paul had to say about pupils in secondary school working out with the school. And one of the things, we went to Raploch Community Campus, and one of the many conversations that I had down there was about issues around teenagers not having that engagement with young children, and maybe there's an opportunity there to maybe involve some parenting skills in PSE and maybe involving them in primary school so they're coming into contact with small children and breaking that cycle, and very importantly having boys and girls doing that so that they're actually going back into primary schools engaging with young children, which the young people that we spoke to found when they were engaged with young children found that hugely rewarding, and it gave them the skills for the future, for when they become parents as well, and there's an opportunity there to break that cycle. I just wondered to have your thoughts on that.
Regularly, I mean, practically week in, week out, have young people from our local high school in doing placements in the school, and from other schools as well. And the three that we've got at the moment, one is male and two are female. And, you know, it's about getting them in, working with the children, building their confidence. But actually, for me, it's about, you know, let's nurture the next phase of teachers that are coming through, and let's give them positive destinations to go with that. So, yeah, so, I mean, we do, as a school, have a number of school children, particularly third years, who come out for week's placements in our school regularly. And we have a lot of events that happen. Again, it does come down to the leadership, I suppose, and the relationship between the cluster and the high school. But the high school put on a number of events for the children to come up that are run by the children at the high school to give them the skills. So there's a lot of that going on just automatically.
That you're talking about the next generation of teachers, but also the next generation of parents as well. And as I say, sort of cutting that vicious circle that you can get into.
Absolutely, and I think through our inspection programme, we see really strong examples of older children supporting younger children through mentoring, through sharing books and sharing literacy work. So that is an area we constantly want to promote, because it benefits both the younger child and often the older child as well, in terms of a whole range of skills for life and skills for work. So it's absolutely something that we see in really strong practice, where older and younger children are paired together or work together, both in particular mentoring schemes or projects or the kinds of placements that Jamie has described. So it's absolutely crucial.
I think it's a point well made in terms of the diversity of work that's going on. One of the things that's happened in the last probably 5 to 10 years is the staying on rate in S5 and S6 has exploded. And we sit with some of our schools now who have a staying on rate of 87-88% in S5. Now that's a completely different set of young people than you would have had 15-20 years ago, where a range of academic courses such as hires and other qualifications might have seen you through. We need a far greater range of experiences for these young people that are staying on at school. And to be frank, we just cannot provide it in school alone. It's not going to take them to where they need to be in the next few years. So there's lots more work going on in college. So within Dundee, we've probably got about 500, over 500 young people that work between Dundee and Dundee College for 2 afternoons a week, doing some kind of certificated work. And we do have some good examples of early years childcare, where we've got groups of young people following a course where they're in school for some of the week, and some of them are in college for other parts of the week, moving on an HNC programme. That makes an awful lot of sense in terms of their progression and getting them into a sustained positive destination. I think what we need to do is break through what I would call marginal working. We're able to do this for some young people, some of the time. How you actually take that to the point of Wood, who's saying it really needs to be greater numbers of young people, that requires far greater coordination, finance, thinking, engagement with employers who have tremendous demands placed on them from a whole range of other sources, and the colleges to be able to provide that at more than the margins so that it can be offered to all young people. But I have to say that I'm optimistic about this. I wasn't so optimistic about it a few years ago because it was difficult to break through from that marginal thinking. But we've now got far more flexible timetables in our secondary. And I think a group of timetablers who really want to work creatively, and that has certainly helped us. It might be generational, maybe younger deputies coming through who are trying to think about different ways of operating the timetable. Timetable played a tremendous hurdle to a lot of these things actually happening. But I'm beginning to see in the last few years real examples of partnership working in a sustained way. So that's something that we need to continue with.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I just finish off by asking a question, probably more to Graham Logan, but it kind of addresses a point that both Lindsay and Joanne made about the circumstances outside of schools impacting on attainment. Now, is the attainment challenge one not really about recognising that and then trying to put in the extra resources to level the playing field at an early stage?
Yes, I mean, it's now a £750 million programme over 5 years to do that, and to allow schools and localities to look at what is it they need to do to make the difference and reduce the impact that poverty has on children's attainment. So it's a very targeted and focused intervention to do exactly that. And at the moment we're working in particular local authorities with high numbers of children living in SAMD 1 and 2 and the same in schools. And as I say, that's the measure we're working with. No measure is perfect, but it's certainly enabling our local partners to really focus in on target the children who need the support to make the difference and give them the same chance in life as children in other areas of Scotland.
Yeah, listen, thank you very much for the evidence session this morning. That was really, really helpful and very, very interesting. So thanks very much for your time. Thank you. That brings us to the conclusion of the public part of the meeting today. So if we can clear the gallery, please.